Okay, I think we can begin. I don't know if you mentioned that there might be some more walk-ins coming in, so we can just kind of get started here. Were any of you at the last lecture I gave? No? So this is all the... Yes, I remember. What's your name again?
Kayla.
Sure. We had that nice conversation. yeah, I think you're going to like this one. Even a bit more than the last one. If you did miss the last one, it's online. My card, I brought them today, is by that table I've got some up here, so just let me know. If you go to the church website and they click on the YouTube channel, you can watch the last lecture. The last one was more mainstream. We did more of an overview of my work. For those of you who don't know me, I am Bishop Bryan Ouellette, Holy Nicholean Catholic Church, which is an independent autocephalous Catholic church that operates out of Atlanta. We are currently affiliated with the Old Roman Catholic Order of Exorcists, the Sacred Order of St. Michael the Archangel, which we affiliated with in 2015. And what we do, some of my members of my team, not everybody is here today, but what we do is we investigate claims of paranormal activity and people that are reporting spiritual crisis, whether it be of an emotional nature, of a pastoral nature, of a psychological nature, or of an actual spiritual condition. And we try to ascertain what that is, and then we get them the help that they need. Sometimes it is, in fact, I would say most of the time, it is psychological in nature. And so therefore, we kind of come in to rest their minds that the devil's not after them, and then hopefully they will be more willing at that point to go and seek psychiatric care. So last time we talked about that work. We talked about how do we determine what demonic possession is. We talked about the different types of demonic involvement, be it obsession, oppression, and infestation. And of course, everyone has heard of possession. Today we're going to be breaking down the essence of what the devil really is on a theological as well as a mythological and esoteric level. And I think this is going to help you to understand, depending upon which side of the spectrum you happen to be on. If you are a believer in Satan, then this is going to help you to understand a little bit more about what his role is in the overall dynamic of the theology that we kind of take for granted. I mean, we now live in a world, as Christians, those of you who consider yourself Christian, we live in a world where it's just accepted that there is this evil force we call Satan that influences our lives in a negative way, tempts us, and we kind of expect the theology and the promise of hope that one day this will be eliminated from our lives at the end of time. And it's going to pose a problem for Christians all across the centuries. Why does evil exist? If we have an all-powerful God, if he's omniscient, if he's omnipresent, and all-powerful, how or why is evil permitted? This has been a big issue for people, and various theologians, from Thomas Aquinas to St. Augustine, did numerous works on trying to explain this problem of evil, as it's called in Christian theology. This is going to help you to understand that a lot better. We're going to step outside of our paradigm a bit, though. So for those who are Christian, this is going to be a challenge for you. For those of you who are not, for those of you who take a more scientific vantage point on these things, for those of you who do not believe in the existence of the devil, this is going to help you too. In fact, you're probably really going to like this because it's going to help explain to you the phenomenon of the devil and the realities behind it, or as I would prefer to put it, the actualities. A lot of this is going to depend upon semantics, so we're going to have to break things down. We don't have a common semantics in the English language like we think we do. And sometimes words are shot around like spirit, soul, body, And we expect and think we know what they mean when we really don't. Body itself is a misnomer, as we will see, because it assumes that a body holds something. And usually the assumption is that the body holds some type of spiritual soul, some element in there. And so therefore, we think of the soul as being contained within. Through the course of this lecture, you're going to see the opposite's actually true. The body is really a reflection of the soul, almost a projection of it. The soul is outside of us. And we will explore that as well. So let's break it down, and we will hopefully do this a little bit differently. Last time I did more of a speech type of presentation. Today we're going to do more of an interactive, okay? So does everybody have a piece of paper and pen handy? Anyone need one?
Yeah, if anybody needs one, I can go grab some if you like.
Raise your hand if you need one.
Okay.
Okay, sure thing. I also want everybody to ask questions as you need to. Don't feel like you have to go to the end. Last time we did a Q&A at the end. It's going to be a lot easier, I think, if we can just ask questions as we go. More of a classroom sort of, and since we're a much smaller group than last time, I think that will be to our benefit. It actually works more for this particular subject matter, I think, to have a smaller group. So I'm actually kind of happy about that. The people at home can email me. While he's getting that, I'll just mention that what we're going to talk about today has been shared for thousands of years amongst the various mystery schools and esoteric institutions of the ages. This is not something that has been really shared outside of these schools. Welcome.
Hello.
Have a seat. Not something that's really shared outside of these mystery schools, although I will say, having been part of the church for a long time in various capacities, and I wasn't always an independent Catholic. I was a Roman Catholic seminarian initially, was accepted by the Diocese of Palm Beach, Florida, and in the course of that time, I almost became a Cistercian monk, spent a great deal of time behind the cloister. I thought that I was going to definitely be a contemplative monk. Sometimes I almost regret not having followed through with it, because it's such a delightful lifestyle. And I am a person that spends a great deal of time in prayer, and living more in the secular world is a challenge to keeping that life going. So the Cistercian monastery was also inspirational in sharing to me some of the secrets of philosophy and theology that is not shared with the masses. And it's true. There's a lot of material that is contained within the library of knowledge that makes up the Christian worldview that's never given to the masses. It's unfortunate, but it's just the way it is. And so we're going to break this down, and you're going to learn some things today that really have never been shared inside the cloister of monasteries or, like I said, the mystery school. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Oh, sir.
Okay. The reason I want you to have a pen and papers, we're going to do a little exercise here. I feel that a lot of what we are going to talk about is requires an experiential component. We can talk about the devil till we're blue in the face, but unless we really experience the devil, we're never really going to understand what this concept is. So no, we're not going to conjure him, but we are going to experience the ways in which he interacts with our lives. And you're going to learn a little bit about the way all things influence your life that you're completely unaware of. The spiritual things create the physical reality. It's not the other way around. Okay. So, close your eyes, and I want you to visualize yourself. Take a few deep breaths if you need to. It sometimes helps me when I start to do a visualization exercise to just inhale deeply, hold it for about 3 seconds, exhale slowly until all the air is exhausted, and hold it for 3 seconds, and then continue to do this 3 or 4 times to get yourself quiet, rested, comfortable, and acclimated to the inner workings of your mind. Keep your eyes closed so that you're not distracted. And the only time I want you to open it is when you're going to write something down. I'm going to give you something to write down as we go through this visual journey. So you've been asleep for hundreds of years, and all of a sudden something startles you awake. And as you awaken, you see yourself in the middle of a forest. I want you to look around yourself and take in a notation as to what does it look like? What does this forest look like to you? What does it smell like? What sounds do you hear? And write down what you see. There's no wrong answer. Whatever your brain decides to produce is the answer that you write down. Try not to direct it. Just let yourself observe objectively. I'll give you a moment to write down what you see, and then we will move on in this internal journey. For those at home, I would encourage you to do it along with us. It will be helpful when we get to the end of the lecture. I'll wait till everybody stops writing and then we'll move on. As you continue to walk through this forest, you notice along the path in front of you, there's a key on the ground. You pick it up. What does the key look like? How does it feel? What color is it? What material is it made of? Even if it's an irrational material, like wood or something, write it down. Write down the first thing that you see. Once again, let your brain create the projection. Don't direct it. Just observe what your brain shows you. As you continue moving on, walking in the path in front of you, this time you notice that there's a vase on the ground. What does it look like? And what do you do with it when you see it? Also with the key, take note of what you did with it after you picked it up. once you have decided what your vase looks like and what you have done with the vase, you continue along the path in front of you in the woods, and this time you come across a wall. What does the wall look like? And what action do you take now that your path is interrupted by this wall? You can't keep going on in front of you. The wall will stop you. What does the wall look like? How large is it? And what do you do once you get to it? As you continue on your journey, depending upon what you did when you get to the wall, that will influence this next one, you'll find that your path is once again blocked, this time by water. What does the water look like? Is it a large river? Is it a gentle stream? You'll take note of what you see initially. Is it a lake? Is it a pond? Is it an ocean? Write down what the water looks like and what you do when you get to it. While you are dealing with your water problem, suddenly a bear, a wild bear, comes out from the woods behind you. What does it look like? And what do you do when you encounter it? The next thing you see, depending upon how you dealt with the bear, is a house. What does the house look like? And what do you do when you reach the house? Leaving the house, you notice that the forest that you've been lost in is starting to break up ahead. So you move towards that breaking of the trees, and when you get there, you find that that opening leads to a road. What does the road look like? What do you do when you find the road? Is it a highway? Is it a twisty, turny kind of little country road? Is it a sidewalk? It's just large enough for bicycles. Take note of what you see. Write down what it looks like and what you do when you get there. Continue to write up your notes if you need to. And we'll come back to this. You might say, what is this about? How does this have to do with the devil? You'll find out. It will all be made clear, I promise. So let's return to the subject at hand now, what you all came for, what you all came to learn about. In order to fully understand and comprehend who and what the devil is, it's first necessary to establish some criteria as to what we mean by the devil. And so, in the Judeo-Christian context, which is the one in which we are operating, or the assumption is, of course, is that, number one, he must be sentient. Okay, that's one of the necessary criteria that we want to look for. Sentient. That's number one. The second is that he must be intelligent. So we're not dealing with a symbol. Symbols are not necessarily sentient, and they're not necessarily intelligent. In order to constitute Satan, we have to constitute a being, something that exists in a independent sense, but is also able to operate at a level that is either equal to or greater than we are, which is the third thing we're looking at. The devil must be preternatural. What we mean by preternatural, you could say that in theological jargon, supernatural is reserved for the things of God. Preternatural is the things that happen outside of nature that are not caused by God, or caused by something actually specifically evil or dark. If it's neutral, then we just use the term paranormal. It could, paranormal, though, could be both supernatural, preternatural, or its own thing. So think of supernatural as a divine event that occurs outside of the natural world. Think of preternatural as a evil or dark event that occurs outside the operations of the natural world. So demonic possession is a preternatural event. It's not supernatural. But you might say a successful exorcism is supernatural. Does that make sense? The last quality is that he must be destructive to creation. That defines the satanic in its most basic function. There's a lot of things that are sentient. There's a lot of things that are intelligent. Preternatural and destructive to creation is its own quality of the satanic. So these are the four things that we must use to understand the devil. Now let's look at what the conventional theology of the church teaches us about the devil. And we're going to go through some very key points that are going to give us clues as we continue this journey towards revealing who he really is. Satan is remarkably absent from the Old Testament. He's there, but not anywhere near the same way that he is in the New Testament. There's a reason for that that we will get into. In fact, it's not until Jesus interacts with him in the temptation of the desert that we actually start to see the devil that we know in the modern world to be familiar. Prior to that, Satan's kind of a shady, mysterious figure. And let's look at some examples. I don't want to inundate you with biblical references, but I'm going to give you a few of the key ones here for reference sake. The most notable is Job. He's working alongside with God. He's not working against God. He's actually saying, I don't think Job's as devout as you think he is. If he he just has a good life, this is why he respects you. But if I take away all of these things, then he's going to, he will most certainly turn his back to you. And of course, Job doesn't. Job proves his righteousness. But the devil God allows the devil to do horrible things to Job to prove Job's fortitude, his commitment. It's kind of an interesting thing. He's like a genuine devil's advocate. And the word that's used in Job, of course, is Satan, right? El Satan in the Hebrew. But he's acting as a member of God's court, not as a separate organization like we see in the later years of the church. In the Hebrew religion, he's actually part of God's system. Another example, in Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1, it says, then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right side to accuse him. Once again, he's acting as part of a divine plan. Not in opposition to it. It's just he has a different role to play than everybody else in God's system. Very different than the Satan that we know as Christians. Or even non-Christians living in a Christian-influenced West. Theologically, the serpent, or the snake in the Garden of Eden has been equated to being the devil or Satan. But the word Satan is never used there. In the original Hebrew, it is literally snake. The Hebrew word for snake, it escapes me, I don't remember what it is, but the word that's used is snake. And in fact, it's even further emphasized as a snake because tempting Adam and Eve to commit original sin, he curses the snake to be forever the slithering creature on the ground. It's clearly not the devil that we know in the New Testament. An aspect, maybe, but not the developed understanding that we have in the Christian worldview. Then we have this very interesting verse in the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 7, where God himself states, "I form the light and create darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all things." All things. Not just some things, not just good things. All things. And very clearly showing in metaphorical language that he's responsible for the good things and the bad things. And we see it happen to Job. The devil could not act without God's permission. Yeah, he had to give that permission. So the devil's actually quite powerless without God's consent. That makes the picture very, very different than we have as conventional Christians or people living in a Christian worldview, people that are influenced by it and thinking that they understand what the devil is. We all think we get it, but we really don't. And you see, the reason for this is that in the Hebrew mind, the ancient Hebrew mind in particular, they were so obsessively monotheistic that the idea that to even suggest that there could be an alternative power that could compete with God, that would be powerful enough to even corrupt his creation, was unthinkable. There was one God. That's what defines the Hebrew religion. That's what defines Judaism to this day. The monotheisms, where essentially monotheism took root. It's not the first monotheism. The first monotheism that we know about occurred in Egypt for a very brief period of time under the pharaoh Akhenaten, I believe. Didn't have enough coffee this morning. There was one pharaoh in Egypt that pushed a monotheism, and he was eventually, they tried to erase him from the face of history. It was just recently discovered, in fact, but there was a one God, it was a one God religion. Some people think that that might have influenced what later became Judaism, because maybe there seemed to be Hebrew people living as slaves in Egypt. We know this from the story of Genesis and Exodus. So there might have been there way back then and took those monotheistic beliefs with them into what was eventually called the Promised Land when they escaped from Egypt. That's just one possibility. We don't know. We don't know exactly. But that's a speculation. Now the mystery gets even further enhanced with the story of Balaam. You might not know this story. It's in the book of Numbers. He's a diviner. He's like the ancient equivalent of a tarot card reader. And he can do various, he's got certain occult powers. And he's living in the Promised Land that the Hebrew people have seen as their land now, that God is bringing them to, or through the Exodus. This is where they're going to come in and conquer all of these nation states that are not really permitted to be there anymore because God gave the Hebrews this land. And so they're going through and just like wiping out all these kings, and they're very successful at it too. And so the king of Moab, Balak, becomes concerned that he's going to be defeated as well. So he goes and he calls on Balaam to use his occult powers to curse the Hebrew people so that he's not going to lose his authority in the land. Balaam tells Balak that he can only do what Yahweh commands him to do. And that God had come to him in a dream and told him not to do what Balak asks. So already he was familiar with the God of the Hebrews and was not willing to, supersede his instruction. Balak persists and appeals to Balaam's greed with gifts and various types of honors. So, at this point, Balaam, being who he is, says, I'm not going to turn this opportunity down, and decides that he's not good. Despite God pressing him further, he's going to do what Balak asks him, and goes to try to curse the Hebrew people, the Israelites. On his way, in Numbers chapter 22, verse 22, we see that an angel of the Lord, it says, appears to Balaam, but Balaam can't see him, but his donkey does. The donkey's riding, and then the donkey stops because he doesn't want to get interfere with the angel. And then Balaam starts beating the donkey. And then suddenly the donkey starts speaking, "Why are you treating me so badly?" And at that point, Balaam's able to see the angel of the Lord, and he repents immediately for making the decision to disobey God. The donkey continues to complain about being physically abused. But this time, the God tells Balaam to go on, but not to curse the Israelites. The story, it's an interesting story. I would encourage you to read the whole thing. I'm giving you just the highlights. But the thing that's important about this is verse 22. The angel of the Lord doesn't seem all that amazing until you read it in the original Hebrew. The Hebrew words that are used there is that the angel of the Lord, before I tell you the Hebrew, let me tell you what Eastern Orthodox tradition and hermeneutics has taught about this verse. The angel of the Lord is actually Jesus Christ. The Roman Catholic Church kind of takes an open interpretation on what these Hebrew concepts mean. But in Orthodoxy sees the big difference between Eastern Orthodoxy and Roman Catholicism is that Eastern Orthodoxy sees all throughout the Old Testament the precursor of the coming of Jesus Christ in every action. Roman Catholic Church sees it too. But they believe that these interactions with the divine that occur in the Old Testament is actually Jesus himself. Just hasn't revealed himself as the Son of God yet. So the angel of the Lord that we see in Numbers 22 is actually Jesus himself in the original ancient Christian theology. We don't see that when we read it in English, of course. But if you know the old hermeneutical explanations, then it becomes very clear. Now, read it in Hebrew. It says that the angel of the Lord is Le Satan, which means Satan. I stand as an adversary before you. The angel of the Lord calls itself the adversary. And the word that's used, now in English you read it as adversary. You don't think that's a big deal. Because you're not talking about the adversary. You're talking about just an adversary. Problem is, Hebrew doesn't have capital letters. Hebrew doesn't even have vowels. Fill all that stuff in. And it can be a little bit subjective when you're looking at ancient documents. But the most important thing about this to remember is that Satan, as a word in the Old Testament, is never essentially a proper name. There's lots of Satans. Anything that stands as an adversary is a Satan. And so therefore, in this context, taking the Eastern Orthodox viewpoint, Jesus himself stands as Satan to Balaam. That's important. We'll explain this in more detail a little bit later on. Another interesting correlation. Now, let's start talking about some of the original languages. And see, these are things that are lost when you read it in English. There's so much of the Bible that is lost in English. You probably, there's one that I can give you a really good example of. The one where Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" And Peter says, "Of course, Lord, I love you." And then he says, "But Peter, do you love me?" And Peter comes back and says, "Of course, Lord, I would do anything for you." And then he comes back and says, "Peter, do you love me?" And then Peter becomes distraught and almost angry at this point. You read that in English and you're like, what's going on here? You read it in Greek and it makes perfect sense. The words, we only have one word for love in English, and that's love. I love my wife. You could say I love my wife, I love God, I love pizza. We use the same word for all of it. In Greek, you'd never say that. You have a special type of word for the type of love you're talking about. So the word for, the word in Greek that's used for the first two times Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? He's using the word that is used for brotherly love. The word that you would use for love between human beings. But when he gets to the third time, he says, Peter, do you love me? He's using the word agape, which is the love you reserve for God alone, the unconditional love for God. And this is why Peter becomes upset, because he realizes, I'm not entirely sure I can really do that. In the English, you're like, why is he upset about this? Maybe he's upset because Jesus keeps asking, but it's not, because Jesus is asking an entirely different thing the third time. This is an example of how when you take it out of the original languages, the Bible loses a lot of its initial meaning, and that's important because understanding Satan is very much dependent upon the original language, as you're going to see here. So now let's look at Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12, which states, how you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. Now, in Christian theology, in the historical context, we have been taught to understand that this is proof of the fallen angel Lucifer, right? Which is another word for Satan, same guy, in conventional understandings. And it's true. The word that is used in the Hebrew, and I'm going to use the Roman alphabet, because it won't mean anything to you if I put it in Hebrew. Hello ben Shahar. That was translated by Saint Jerome when he wrote down the scriptures in Latin as Lucifer. It is continued into the King James Version of the Bible. When you go to that verse, Isaiah 14, chapter 12, you're going to see that they're talking about, how have you fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn? Lucifer's the word that's used. So it doesn't matter if you're using the Catholic Vulgate or the Protestant King James, we're talking about Lucifer. Problem is, the word Lucifer, translates as a bringer of the door or star of the morning or morning star. There's different ways you would translate it. That's what Lucifer means in English. Morning star is also associated with the planet Venus. It's also important to recognize that. Okay. But the original Hebrew said Hallel ben Shahar. Didn't say Lucifer. Didn't give a name. Not necessarily a name. Remember, there's no capital letters, so there's no real distinction of proper nouns versus common nouns. There is an old Canaanite myth that precedes the scriptures of a god who is known as Shahar, son of El. Well, I guess I should
We are using English, so we'll just go.
This is the God of the dawn. In the Canaanite mythology, Shahar ushers in the dawn every day. He makes the dawn possible. He starts the new day. His brother, Shalim, also son of El, is the god of dusk. He ends the day. The planet Venus will sometimes rise in the morning, early morning, and then immediately goes right back down. And sometimes it will rise at dusk for a period of time, then it goes right back down. It doesn't have the same pattern of going across the sky. So when the ancients looked at it, of course they always associated heavenly bodies with the apparitions of their deities. Shahar brought the dawn, and Shalim also related to the planet Venus. They're both related to the same star, the same planet, brought in the dusk, depending upon which time of year it was. This is important because Hillel ben Shahar, Shahar is spelled exactly the same way in the Hebrew as it is in this more ancient myth. And Hillel is the Hebrew word for Lucifer, son of the morning, or morning star. So you might not think that that's terribly earth-shattering, but it becomes extremely problematic as we get it further into the New Testament. Because in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, it states, "We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts." In Revelation chapter 2, verse 26 through 29, it states, "To the one who is victorious and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations. The one will rule them with an iron scepter and will dash them to pieces like pottery, just as I have received authority from my Father. I will also give that one the morning star. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." And then later in verse 22, chapter 22, verse 16, "I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star." Of course, the Greek word that's used is phosphorus, morning star. But if you were to translate it back into Hebrew, it would be Hillel. And Hillel, we know, when you translate it to Latin, is Lucifer. In a sense, you could say Jesus calls himself Lucifer. There is a Roman Catholic hymn. Go look it up on YouTube, because there's an evangelical group that's using this to convince the world that Roman Catholics are actually Satanists. Because there is a hymn that is said, particularly in the Vatican still uses a lot of Latin in its liturgy. Not so much, we don't see it as much in the United States, it's more English. And preferences towards the vernacular. But there is a hymn that's said at Easter, where it chants out to Lucifer. It's not talking about Satan, of course, it's talking about Jesus as the morning star, just like in the book of Revelation. And so, how do theologians, conventional theologians, reconcile this problem? Well, they they had to come, scramble and come up with something that's really not very good if you break it down. It's a very modern resolution, in other words. And that is to say that, oh, Lucifer wants to be like God. So he's calling himself the Morning Star when he really isn't. And then, of course, we have the references of Lucifer being able to disguise himself as an angel of light. And then we have all of the mythos going back to Lucifer falling from heaven. Even Jesus says, I saw him fall from the heavens. And that's an ancient myth, again, going back to Shahar, watching Venus go up and then come back down in the morning and then in the evening. That's where it comes from. When Jesus says, I saw him fall from heaven, he's talking about the planet Venus. Because that was the ancient Canaanite myth that was still very much an active belief system in the Hebrew world at the time of Jesus. So this can be really, really problematic for people. So the churches, the conventional churches won't talk about it. That's one of the benefits of being independent Catholic. We can go a little bit further than the Roman Catholic Vatican would allow. Not that we change anything, we don't. We just, we have less restrictions on us to try to maintain status quo. And so we can talk about the things that nobody wants to talk about outside of the cloisters, where it's pretty much safer, where people are not going to maybe become scandalized by this stuff. But I will try not to scandalize anyone here. I will hopefully be able to enlighten you on it. So we have to ask, why is it so easy to form a perfect correlation between Jesus and Satan? Why are they using the same words about themselves? And why does the original language demonstrate almost that we're talking about the same thing? To answer this, we have to deviate from the conventional theology. Big surprise, because the conventional theology is going to stop here. It's not going to let you go any further, because it doesn't want you to go any further. So we have to go into the mystery schools. We have to go into the esoteric branches of theology and philosophy in order to answer this problematic question. First is, who is Satan? And second of all, why is Jesus so intimately connected to him, in almost the sense of being the same person, using the same words, the same terminologies, the same mythos? Of course, Shahar and Shalim were not evil. It's just this was their operation, to bring in the dawn, to bring in dusk. Incidentally, it might be interesting that to note that the original Hebrew word for Jerusalem, the holy city, is Jaru Salam. Shalim is actually very closely related in the Hebrew to Shalom. Salam. Shalim and Salam. In fact, so much so that most biblical scholars who deal with the original languages, I don't speak Hebrew, but many of the ones that do feel that the word Jerusalem is a carryover from Shalim. So now we have the holy city involved, the city where Jesus dies. Shalim ushers in the dusk, falls from heaven. Jesus dies in Jerusalem on the cross. Okay, there's an important correlation to that. So let's get into, I'll try to write this down. We'll leave this for a moment. And I'll leave that up on the other side there. Let's talk about a branch of study that I call esoteric mysticism. This is what we can use to answer this question. And let's define it. Again, remember I mentioned a lot of this is semantics, so now we need to really get into understanding what our words mean. And we're going to have a lot of them, so I'm going to try to make it as easy as possible. There's so much that I could give you that it would be here for the next weekend, and we don't want to go that far. So let me try to make it as, just break down the important points. Esoteric mysticism can be defined as mysticism purified of any and all superfluous religious preconceived notions, or, more simply, the pure activity of awakening. Okay? So think of it as the mystical pursuit without the influence of specific theologies creating paradigms that mysticism must fall into. It's easy to say, I'm a Christian mystic, and say, okay, I had an experience, Jesus came to me, and the church has numerous examples of saints reporting this. But the problem with it is, Buddhists have these experiences too. Hindus have these experiences too. Muslims have these experiences too. It's not Jesus coming to them. It's something that is a symbol of what they can relate to, something that's important to their worldview. And so therefore, mysticism tends to very quickly attach to the conceptualizations that are relevant to our worldview. Esoteric mysticism just focuses on mysticism without the worldview. Allows us to see a little bit clearer because we're not being influenced by what we expect or what we want to be true. This is an observation system. It is not a belief system. In fact, it is the opposite of belief. One of the axioms of the system is beliefs are poison. Why do we call it poison? Because it contaminates everything that it touches. So we don't go into esoteric mysticism believing anything. Doesn't mean that we no longer be Christians or Muslims or Hindus or whatever it is that we subscribe to. It just means that when we engage in esoteric mysticism, we put all of those notions aside and just try to see what is. So it's very scientific in the sense that we're not going in with preconceived notions and we're not being influenced by what we want to believe is true. And even science will suffer that same consequence without the objectivity of what we're talking about here. Because, I mean, certainly scientists can even go into a study saying, well, of course I don't believe in God. So that affects how they see certain things in the process of their observations. It affects their conclusions. If you don't want to see God, you're not going to see God. And if you want to see God, you're most definitely going to see God in everything. That's a problem. We need to know, is God there or not? Esoteric mysticism gives us the tools to do that because we're not going in with preconceived notions, we're being objective. Okay. Esoteric mysticism, of course, is a complex study. It takes many years to form the realizations that we do. I can't go into all of it. It would be more of a series, almost like several years of study that we would do weekly in order to go through everything that is esoteric mysticism. I wrote a book about it, and we shared it with a few key people. And the results of that reading, and of course none of the people who read it knew who the other people were, was so disastrous that I just decided I'm not going to publish this book. People were not ready for it. And so there's a lot to it that we have to be careful of. The most important concept in understanding all philosophy, all religion, all theology, spirituality, mysticism, esotericism, and occultism is the notion of, and there is no more important word here, archetype. Okay, archetype. Carl Jung is one of the first to really talk about this in any detail. Carl Jung was a personality theorist, studied under Freud. Psychologists love him. Some psychologists love him. The more of the Freudian types tend to like Jung a little bit more than the more cognitive therapists who are more of a behaviorist model. If you're into psychoanalysts, you know about Carl Jung, you know about Freud, you know about archetypes. Carl Jung defines an archetype this way, more semantics, sorry for all these definitions, but it's important that we know what we're talking about. The archetype concept, this is Jung's words now, the archetype concept derives from the often repeated observation that myths and universal literature stories contain well-defined themes which appear every time and everywhere. We often meet these themes in the fantasies, dreams, delirious ideas, and illusions of persons living nowadays. These themes are representations of archetypes. They are based on archetypes. They impress, influence, and fascinate our egos. This is why we call their tremendous effect numinous, that is, able to arise deep in intense emotions. Archetypes do not have a well-defined shape, but from the moment they become conscious, namely nurtured, with the stuff of conscious experience. We should know some parent archetypes, I would think. You might have heard of the anima and the animus. You might have heard of the shadow, the wise old man, the great mother, eternal child, trickster. These are themes. And I promise you, every movie you have ever been to, every television show you've ever watched, every book you've ever written, novel, every work of nonfiction you've ever heard contains these parent archetypes in some form or fashion. The hero? We all know the hero. That's an archetype. Most stories are about the hero. And the hero follows a specific formula. He's usually an unwilling participant in the beginning, where this mission is thrust upon him, and he doesn't want it, but he takes it anyway. And then he goes and he travels to the underworld and he goes through all these trials, and then at the end he arises victorious. That's every movie you have ever been to, practically, if it's an adventure at least. It's almost every movie you've ever been to. We all know the hero. And who's he fighting? He's usually fighting either a trickster or a shadow. Usually a shadow of himself, an antithesis to himself, an anti-hero. Right? That's Darth Vader. And Star Wars. Star Wars is a wonderful archetypal story. You know, Luke Skywalker is the hero, the unknowing participant, all falls backwards into a mission that he needs to now save the galaxy against his own father, Darth Vader, you know, who becomes his antithesis. He is his shadow. Batman's sort of an anti-hero. And who is his arch-nemesis? The Joker, a trickster, very violent trickster. It's an archetype. We all know these archetypes. In fact, when we started this class, I gave you an experiential archetypal journey. That's what I had you write down, so that you can see how intimately connected you are to these archetypes. But we have to make them conscious before we're fully aware of them. And you're going to learn a lot about yourself at the end of this class, because we're going to analyze what those archetypes mean. And you're going to see things about yourself that you probably might have known or suspected, or maybe you don't want to know, but you're going to be forced to deal with. Jung was 99.9% right in his definition here. There's only the exception of one minor detail that he got wrong. And that is, we do not animate or give life to the archetypes. It is the archetypes that animate us. It's the other way around. We don't realize that, because we think about our brains as being in control. You need to start to think about your brain as more of a receptor for information rather than a generator of it. Your thoughts, your feelings, and this is part of why I had you do that little exercise. By the way, that is a Freudian projection test. Uses archetypes. Might have been actually Carl Jung. I'm not sure which one developed it. But it's used in psychoanalysts even to this day to reveal things about the subconscious nature of our personalities. And you will learn as you deal with these things and get more intimate with them, you'll see that you're not really influencing these stories. These stories are actually influencing you. You have created a story for your life, whether you realize it or not, whether you like it or not. your entire identity is a construct of archetypal patterns that have come together to form an identity that you call you. That is not a real self. It's just a story. No different than Star Wars and Luke and Darth Vader and all that. Let's break it down even further. More words, I'm sorry. More semantics. The human vocabulary is great, but it doesn't give us everything we need. Important word in esoteric mysticism is cosmos. We can call the cosmos a lot of things. What do we mean when we say cosmos? Scientifically, it means something. Spiritually, it might mean something. A lot of people use the word. We all think we know what it means. And all the different meanings that it has are true. So we need to break it down in such a way that it makes sense. So let's give it a definition that we all can use to be consistent here today. We can call the cosmos God. Understood to be the activity of the multiverse, as opposed to conventional theological notions of God existing as a sentient being. Okay? So, God, yes, theologically speaking, is a sentient, omnipresent creator of all. We can, there's no conflict here. We can use that. But let's step outside of the paradigm of religion for a minute and just say, what ultimately is God at the most fundamental level, as far as purposes of science are concerned? Science isn't concerned about an omnipresent being. It doesn't care about those things. What science does care about is function. So the activity of the cosmos, what animates it, what puts it into motion, we can say is God. We will use the word cosmos in this context for purposes of esoteric mysticism. That way we don't use we don't get into the religious connotations of God. We can just say cosmos, which is a much purer word of paradigm shifts. Our paradigms, we say God, we start thinking about the man in the sky. We don't want to invoke that image for this exercise. We want to just see his activity. Because we all can agree, whether you believe in God or not, we can all agree that the universe is animated. It moves. It functions. And it functions remarkably well. The very fact that life exists at all is remarkable. Because take God out of the equation, it shouldn't exist at all. This planet got by just fine for millions of years with single-cell organisms, which are very efficient. They don't really harm the environment. We're very inefficient creatures. We destroy things. Intelligence does not work to the benefit of the universe. Not at all. The universe doesn't need a sentient awareness to exist. It can just be. Why does there have to be an observer? The very fact that we have an observer means that there's something interesting happening that's extending outside of the regular framework. So that's why we use the word cosmos instead of God. What we're referring to here is the action of the entirety of the multiverse. Why do I say multiverse? Because you will learn that there isn't just one universe. There are numerous universes. In fact, theoretical physics and experiential physicists and all sorts of innovative thinkers today are starting to realize that there might be far more than, that there might be infinite numbers of universes. And so we have to take into consideration that the universe isn't big enough. We need to, when we talk about cosmos, we're talking about everything. Even though the word universe means everything, it doesn't really contain other universes. Cosmos does, okay? And we'll break that down. So now, let's talk about how this happens. I'm trying to stay under 2 hours, so I'll do my best. Because I want to have time to have a conversation. So how did it all happen? Christians, Jews, and Muslims say it was a creation. There's a lot of evangelical Protestant groups that are even refer to themselves as creationists. And that is this notion that what is contained in the book of Genesis is the actual scientific explanation for how the universe came to be, and that would put the world at about 7,000 something years old, and that there's a creationist museum somewhere, I'm not sure where, is it Kentucky or Tennessee, Kentucky?
Kentucky.
Yeah, and they've got like dinosaurs with cavemen, it's ridiculous. No. That is archetypal thinking. They created a story, they used theology, they created a story, and they started believing the story instead of understanding what the story was really teaching them. Genesis is not trying to teach us that the world is 7,000 years old. Genesis is not trying to teach us that creation is this instantaneous process, or instantaneous moment. It is an entire process from beginning to end, all occurring at the same time, because you're dealing with a reality that is existing outside of time. People want to say, well, let's talk theologically for just a moment, and I'll give you an example of how this works. People ask me all the time, is the devil redeemable? Will there be a time where if he repented, could he be redeemed? Would God forgive him? And the answer to that is very simple. No, he's not redeemable, because angels exist outside of time. And so when an angel, I'm talking theologically now, okay? When an angel makes a decision, it's an eternal decision. Because there is no changing your mind maybe tomorrow or the next day, or maybe waking up and realizing, I wasn't right. The decision is eternal. Because think about it, if you did not live within the framework of linear time, with a past, present, and future, every decision you made would be happening at all moments, at all times, forever. This is the way in which, theologically speaking, angels make decisions. So the devil is not able to be redeemed because he's already made his eternal decision, and there is no changing his mind, because he could have changed his mind before he made the decision. And there was no before he made the decision, because it was an instant process. It's outside of time. Very difficult to comprehend. The reason I use that is because it's important to understanding the process of creation. What is creation? Easy. And I don't understand why people have such a hard time with this. Creation is evolution. Evolution is just the process of watching it unfold. It's not a conflict. Creationists and evolutionists are not at war, except because they believe their stories. They're little archetypal stories, and they're not willing to step outside of their paradigms. But as long as you're willing to no longer engage paradigms by engaging a system that's free of paradigms, you're able to see things clearly. And so what we say creation is, what Christians and Jews and Muslims want to say, is something that happened instantaneously. Science is saying it's something that's a constant process that is unfolding. They're both right, they're both true. In fact, Roman Catholic Church has never been an evolutionist religion. Roman Catholic Church has actually affirmed that evolution is the best scientific model. While it's not complete, and even scientists will say it's not a complete theory, and it is still a theory. They say there is nothing within the theory of evolution as it currently is taught by science that conflicts with the teaching of the church. That's a very enlightened view, I think, which is part of the reason why I like Catholicism. Not just because I am Catholic, but it's actually the best way to look at things if you're going to be Christian. So, how did it all start? What is this? Well, we know from the teaching of science that there was what we call the Big Bang. That's the best model we got right now. So we'll say, okay, that's good, that's true. Big Bang, a singularity, the size of about a grain of rice, contained all of the matter of the universe compressed into that one point. It formed a singularity. And at that moment, everything was whole. There was no division. There was no movement. There was no motion. There was no contrast. It just was the singularity, existing in a state of nothingness. The Buddhists call shunyata, by the way. We can talk about that later if you're interested. This represents that singularity. We call it an esoteric mysticism. The unknowable actuality of the cosmos is fundamentally experienced through the breath of God spawning from a singular totality of beingness, which is creation, and non-beingness, which is annihilation, and the space in between, which is what the Buddhists call the bardo. So, this singularity at the point just before the Big Bang contained all of everything that would exist and all of and all of the processes that would eventually come to destroy it, which is God's inhale. His exhale breathes things into creation. It exists for a period of time, and then it gets reabsorbed. His inhale. So we could say that you have three conditions. You have creation, you have evolution, which is the bardo, and then you have reabsorption. Creation, evolution, reabsorption. Creation, destruction. Okay? So, what happens? What happened to this perfect totality, this state of perfection? What occurred that changed this thing that's the price, this thing that's the price, the size of a grain of rice into this infinite cosmos, seemingly infinite? Let's go to Taoism for a moment to explain that. Probably seen this symbol. It's called the Tai Chi Two symbol. It's an Asian symbol. It's in Taoism, Confucianism, and it's very important. You might know it as the yin and yang. Yin represented in the dark space is all of the darkness, the subtle, the principles of the passive qualities. The bright side is the active yang principle. This is where the action occurs. The yin is quiet, the yang is aggressive. The yin is passive, the yang is active. Male, female. And then contained within each point is its polar opposite. Every amount of yin energy has just a little bit of yang. And every element of yang energy has just a little bit of yin. In the beginning, it all worked together as a singularity. It was all just one thing. A cosmic fracture occurs within the space between beingness and non-beingness. So in the beginning, there was both everything that would take form and nothing that would take form. It projects the totality away from itself in a unidirectional action, which we have called in science to be the Big Bang, thus producing complementary polar conditions with countless empty potentialities that we, in esoteric mysticism, call aggregate structures. The totality casts a reflection now. Why is that so? And let me try to explain this in ways that don't get too confusing. Have you ever, anybody ever worked with Photoshop? Anybody ever worked with photo editing? Anybody? Okay, if you take a picture, and particularly if you're taking a black and white picture, it's a better example. Even if you're developing it from actual film, you have to put it through a process of of establishing a perfect balance of contrast. If you don't, you don't have a good picture. And if you're taking a photography class, your teacher's going to flunk you, because that's what they look for. They want to make sure that the picture has good contrast. If I have too much contrast, whether it be actual development or whether it be Photoshop on a digital photo, it's going to wash the whole picture out and it disappears and it goes white. And it will look like a completely blank piece of paper. If I put too much contrast in, it's going to go all dark. And it will look like just a black piece of paper. You won't see the picture anymore. You need to have the contrast in order to see the picture. Thus, if you lived in an entire singularity where only you existed, you would never be able to know yourself. Because what would you be able to look at that would be able to give you an identity? Nothing. You couldn't see, you couldn't step outside yourself. There is nothing outside yourself. The very fact that there's no contrast means that we can look at each other. I can see you, you can see me. Now we can start to form an identity and say, oh, there's something here. And we can make observations because now there's more than just us. This is the cosmic fracture that created the universe. This is the Big Bang. It is a perfectly balanced operation. And it forms a consistent vehicle of constant creation and constant reabsorption. How did this happen? How did this go from this? It's the same way this goes back into this. At the end of time, it will all compress again. They call it the Big Crunch. Some people say the universe will suffer a cold death. All the energy will be expended and it just goes into darkness. But that's not consistent with the models that we've observed at the metaphysical level. It might be true at certain scientific physical levels, but when you take into consideration metaphysics as an element to understanding this type of thing, you realize that it always comes back into itself. Again, God's exhale, God's inhale. Exhale everything into being, inhales everything back into the singularity. For the period of time that this operates, because now we have more than one principle, right? We have one principle here. This is just one principle. Now we've got two principles, yin and yang. And then the seed of each, which makes a third principle, the three dimensions that make up our reality, height, width, and length. That's how we have three dimensions, which allows us to experience the world through the careful configuration of the balance of active and passive activities, or cosmic activities. And like all activity, it leaves an impression. And that impression creates a reflection. That reflection contains shadows of each primary cosmic condition. There are three cosmic conditions that make up what we can say constitutes God in a scientific sense, not necessarily a theological one. And those are awareness, intention, and compassion. Those should not exist. Now you could say, some evolutionists will say, compassion allows us to not kill each other, which allows for the survival of the species. And yes, to a certain extent, that's true. But single-cell organisms, once again, got by just fine without compassion. Things can live and survive without compassion. Maybe not intelligent things, but things can survive. So it's not enough to say, oh, well, you know, this serves an evolutionary purpose. Well, yeah, it does. That's not the reason it exists, though. We shouldn't have the ability to be aware. We don't need it. Life can exist without awareness, and yet awareness exists. The universe cannot create anything that isn't an element of itself. And so therefore, at some fundamental level, within this system of functioning, it generates the capacity for awareness. It generates the capacity for intention, and it generates the capacity for compassion. Awareness, intention, compassion. How do we experience it, though? We experience it as a shadow. A shadow reflected. We don't experience the real things. You didn't think you did you? You really don't. What's the accident of awareness? Consciousness. We don't have pure awareness. No, we have awareness contaminated by paradigms and biases. This or that, us or them, this thing versus that thing. Instead of the polarity of yin and yang, we have the duality of things that are like us and things that are not like us. Things that are safe are like us, things that are not safe, possibly dangerous, let's shun them. Let's hate them. Compassion? We don't feel that. Compassion's not even really an emotion. It's just a state. We can cultivate it, but what do we need to use to cultivate it? The accident of compassion is love. We don't experience compassion, but we do experience love. And so love allows us to have the illusion of compassion. Even though most of the time love is self-fulfilling and self-justifying. Do you fall in love with people that serve you no personal benefit? Probably not. I mean, you want a mutual relationship, don't you? So, I mean, if you're going to fall in love with somebody, whoever it is, you want them to love you the same way. And presumably you're getting something out of it. You like to be with them, maybe they make you happy. So you're using love as a means to self-gratify. That's not compassion. Compassion would be unconditional. You would give love anyway. Didn't matter if they were like you or not. Didn't matter if they were safe. Didn't matter if they hate you. You do it anyway. And then the last is intention. We don't experience intentions. We can't have intentions. We think we do. But we really don't. Intention, for our purposes, is what we call free will. It's not really free will. We don't really intend to do anything. We just simply go through the motions of our story, the one that we've created. Partially through our own operations within the human mind, but also through the archetypal patterns that influence the manifestation of our being, which we'll talk about the archetypal patterns in a minute. This manifests in a form of what is known as the archetypal pattern through the unidirectional movement of the cosmos that was created at the cosmic fracture point. We call it evolution. Things go towards more complex things, right? We don't go to more simple forms. We move, biological beings move towards more states of greater complexity. So if you're looking at purely a scientific model, you could say we start as single-cell organisms, eventually that formed into, you know, some basic marine life that, that marine life came out of the water, eventually reptiles, then birds, then eventually simple mammals, more complex mammals, leading all the way up to human beings. You could say that that's the process of evolution. It got more complex. We got more intelligent. We might be getting stupid. It seems like that sometimes. But we're really not supposed to be getting stupid. We're supposed to be, you know, growing in intellect. And so the process of evolution leads towards greater complexity. There's nothing else in the universe that does this. If I create a sandcastle, let's say you and I go to the beach and we say, we're going to build the greatest sandcastle that ever was. And so we go out there, we take a trip out there, and we get a hotel and we plan to spend the whole week out there building this castle. So we go out there and every day we go and we build this thing. And we build this remarkable thing. most beautiful sandcastle that ever was, makes the news. And then we say, you know what? Let's stay another week and enjoy it. So we do. But we don't do any more work to it. We just go out there every day and take a look at it. Do you think it's going to, in another week time, do you think it's going to now all of a sudden grow new buildings and it be like this, now it's this whole row, this whole village? You know, it's got a little king and queen sitting on a throne now. It's maybe even producing electricity. So, I mean, now it's like this lit up thing at night. No. We'll be lucky if it's still there the next day. It's going to break away. The scientific word for that is entropy, meaning that things go from, the rule in this universe is that things go from complexity down to more simple forms. So therefore we exhaust energy. We start out with a lot of energy and then we exhaust that energy and then it goes away. We call that death for our human experience. That's why we can't live forever, because we're entropic. Entropic beings living in an entropic universe. This is why things seem programmed towards evil. You wonder why the world shouldn't be programmed towards good. Did you ever stop and look at the world and say, why aren't the good things the norm? Why are the bad things? And if you've ever had a good thing happen to you, and then a really bad thing happen to you, why did the real bad thing seem so much worse than the good thing was good? The greatest love in the world does not feel as good as the worst hate, because the worst hate has the capacity to torture you. The greatest love, all it can do is just make you feel happy for a moment, which is very fleeting because we're fickle. And even when we fall in love with someone, those emotions change. Relationship changes over time. And only the strongest of friendships can endure a marriage like that, because the love will not stay the same. It can't. Entropy will take over. And yet we have this marvelous thing called evolution, where for whatever reason, the universe decides for this one thing, life, we're going to break the pattern of this entire universal operation. And we're going to go from simple things to greater levels of complexity. That is what religion has called God. And it, as we said, it reflects archetypally. So here's our first condition. Here's our second condition. Our third condition is the archetypal pattern. The reflection contains, let me repeat this again. The reflection contains shadows of each primary cosmic condition, that is awareness, intention, and compassion, and manifests each in the form of an archetypal pattern that is guided by the unidirectional movement of the cosmic fracture in the form of evolution, or we can call it the evolutionary directive. Remember, things go from the past to the future. They don't go from the future to the past. Even scientists who think time travel is possible, in fact, time travel is possible if you can go fast enough and not die. You can send things into the future, though. If you go close enough to the speed of light, the time changes. Einstein proves this in relativity. But what is also established is that we can't go backwards, though. There's no way to reverse the unidirectional movement of the cosmos. It is fixed in that one unidirectional motion that we call evolution. It fills the aggregate structures. These are the aggregate structures. Let me define that for you real quick. I'll give you my official definition here. These are the qualities that make up a living human being, often misunderstood as a sense of self or personal soul. Okay? So, this emptiness makes up this emptiness creates the space that allows us to have the story. So you might say, well, where does our story come from? I'm Brian Ouellette, I'm a bishop. I've done all these things. I lived in Florida, I was born in Rhode Island. That's my story. Where did that story come from? I didn't create that story. It's created for me, but it feels like I did it, because I have an identity that feels real. It feels like me. It's not me. It's just an impression of a story that just so happens to be my little segment of this operation. but it becomes an archetypal story. When enough of these empty aggregate structures are filled with archetypal patterns sourced to reflect again the complex shadow cast by the totality of the cosmic process and that is vibrated within the fabric of the cosmic fracture, a human being is born. So what does that mean? It means that you all are, myself included, are a reflection of a reflection. We're two steps removed from the actuality of all things. This is why science struggles with God, and this is why religion struggles with science. Because we don't have the totality. We can only assume the totality by making good observations, which science tends to be a little bit better at than religion, but not always. And let me explain that through another graphic here that hopefully will make this make sense. And then we'll bring it all together because I don't want to take too much of your time and I want to leave some time for questions. Let's look at the diagram of reality. This is the line of truth. Pontius Pilate in the scriptures says, what is true? It might just be the most enlightened thing the scriptures contain in reality, because that is the eternal question, isn't it? What is truth? Well, I mean, if I was sexually abused as a child by a priest, as a lot of, unfortunate cases we've heard in recent times, I'm probably going to hate religion. I'm probably going to hate priests. Maybe I won't, but you know, if I've been really hurt and I don't really have a good grasp on the challenges that created for me, then I'm going to create a reality that religion's evil, priests are bad, and you know what? That's truth to that person. That's truth to me. If that happened, it didn't happen to me. But let's just say, for the example's sake, it's truth. But somebody else who's been a good Roman Catholic all their lives and had great priests, grew up with great priests, had wonderful religious experiences, maybe even joined a religious order and became a priest themselves. That's their truth. They're both true. Belief exists on this side of the spectrum. This path that we call the path of awareness leads us closer and closer to this condition, which is actuality. We don't call it reality, because reality, we could say, is just an agreed upon perception, and all of our perceptions are wrong. We don't really see the real, we don't see the universe the way it really is. All the universe is vibration. It's vibratory. We can't see vibrations, though. We have to create some type of experiential reality out of it. And so therefore those vibrations create impressions, and those impressions create the physical matter that makes up the universe and the energy that sustains it. So this is the actuality. It's unknowable. Remember this unknowable condition from before? It's unknowable. We can't ever see the actuality, but we can get closer to it by following the path of awareness. Path of delusion, however, goes back this way. The closer you get to belief, the further you are away from what is actual. It's all truth. Beliefs are true. How you believe, what you believe about your life is true, but it's not actual. You want to be somewhere up here. We call this line, I call the mystical point of awakening. Because once you cross this line, you're able to understand that there is absolute truth, and conventional truth. Absolute truth is closer to the way things actually are. Conventional truth is closer to the way we believe things. So, is a person who believes in Jesus Christ as the Son of God in error? Is that wrong? Is that false? Absolutely not. It's 100% true. But it's on this side of the diagram of reality. The reality is conventionally true. It's conventional because it only applies to the people who are capable of believing it, which is according to the story that you were given archetypally. That wasn't even your choice. It just so happened that way. It might seem like you made that choice. They say, well, what about free will? Well, yeah, there's free will. Free will is true, but we cannot go against the ultimate unidirectional motion of the cosmos. So we can shift how that moves. So we can create through our choices smooth sailing or a lot of trouble. But in the end, it all leads to the same place. And even scripture tells us this. If you want to be completely on the conventional side of the spectrum, that's perfectly fine. If you want to absorb the theology over the science, it's great. What does the theology teach us? That at the end of time, Jesus returns, and a new heaven and a new earth will be put into place where entropy will be no more. And then we live in a state of what is known as ectropy. Evolution is ectropic. Ectropy is the opposite of entropy. That's, again, going back to things moving from simple forms to complex forms, going from less energy to more energy. It tricks the dying process is tricked. Evolution, ironically, is the best proof that science will ever have of God. And it's used as a weapon against people who believe in God. That's the universe having its laugh at us. I can promise you that. So here's belief over here. That's where all our theologies are. Muslim belief is there too. Hindu belief, beliefs that contradict other beliefs. They're all in the conventional pocket. They're all true. Archetypally, the stories are true. But they're not actual. Science wants to spend a lot of its time on this side. Science wants to just not deal with it. The problem is even science creates stories. That's why evolution is called a theory. Because even it can't see the actuality. So it comes up with observations and says, this is the best thing that we can come up with based upon what we can see. And then it goes from there. A little close to the absolute truth, yeah, that's fine. But it is still a story. Evolution is still a story. It's a better story than a lie, but it's still just a story. Okay, so let's use the remainder of this time. I'll try to keep it to see if we can get done around. What is it? That clock's running a little bit fast, so it's about 2:48. So let's see if we can get through this to 3:00, and then we can ask your questions. Okay. So now, absolute truth is the side of awareness that is aligned more perfectly to conditions that are actual in relation to all things being and non-being, while conventional truth is the side of awareness that is contaminated by ego reality along with its propensity to identify too closely with perceptive errors. Archetypal patterns manifest in this realm of awareness via an endless collection of stories. These stories contain hints of the actuality of the cosmos but are often elusive to human consciousness due to the proclivity to attach and identify the story with itself. In a sense, the fictitious character, or our ego, that appears within the pages of the archetypal novel begins to believe the story is real. So here's the big problem between absolute truth and conventional truth. You live in your story, you can't change that. That's part of how the cosmos operates. That's part of its functioning. The problem happens when you start to believe your story. Again, remember what we said about beliefs being toxic. These are poison. This is why. Because what it does is it creates a paradigm that you latch on to. And then when, as soon as you have a paradigm working in your life, the biases quickly happen. And our brains are made to be that way. Because that's how survival occurs. again, let's get back to why we gravitate towards things that are similar. Because things, those are safe. Why do we have wars with different countries? Why do we have wars with different cultures? Why do religions fight each other? Because things that are not like itself are perceived to be dangerous, even when they're not. But in a lot of cases, the stereotypes prove themselves to be true. Islam's a good example. Islam, they invaded the West. We didn't invade them. They came to the West, you know, and that's what started the Crusades. And so therefore, eventually, the mistrust of Middle Easterners and the mistrust of the entire demographic, the entire religion, is the result. We created an us versus them because they're dangerous. They prove themselves dangerous. So we start to believe that. And that is the seed of racism. It's the seed of just about every ism there is. Every dysfunction in the world is the result. Again, why? Because we don't see polarity, we see duality. That's the accident of polarity. The real condition is it's just yin and yang. It's not good and evil, it's yin and yang. Active and passive, creative and destructive, creative and destructive. That's all it is. And we shouldn't use the word destructive, because even that's kind of provocative. We can say reabsorption. Because it just pulls it back into itself. It destroys it in the process of doing that, but it uses that energy to create it again. So when this universe eventually dies, it will all, in the process of the big crunch, return to a state of a singularity until it all spawns again. So creation happens all over again. That's how creation happened. You want to know what happened before the Big Bang? Well, it was one of these. It was another universe. Another cosmos. One that we'll never know, but one that I assure you we're all a part of. We just don't remember it because, guess what? That information doesn't get carried on. You don't have a self to carry it on with. But if you have, you know, people that feel that they've reincarnated, this is why they feel that way. Because it's the carryover of information that stayed in the universe. That doesn't, we know from the laws of thermodynamics that things, energy is not created or destroyed, right? So the energy remains. Doesn't mean it remains cohesive, though. So the complexity of the self, our personal archetypal story, that dies with you. That goes with the body. Unless you trick it through the processes of an entropy, which is what Jesus and all of the religions that teach about an afterlife, this is what it's actually talking about. Talking about a way to trick this process so that you can maintain your cohesion after death and not die and become nothing, which would be the natural condition. That's what made Jesus such a remarkable teacher, because prior to that, they didn't have any knowledge of, there was no real notion of afterlife. There was Sheol, but Sheol was sort of like this shadowy world where you kind of was, you just drifted into nothingness, unconsciousness, you weren't aware of it. Jesus gave that's where the concept of eternal life and becoming one with God comes from. Becoming one with this process. Becoming sort of a cosmic master, if you will. And so that's the nature of absolute and conventional truth. So now that we've broken down the metaphysics of it, let's go back to our original subject about the devil. Because we've kind of gone off on a long tangent, but it was necessary because you'll never get what we're going to go at looking at here until you understand some of these things. Looking at how the conventional theology plays out while also being ever mindful of the archetypal process we just described, Satan is the archetypal result of Jesus purifying humanity of the original sin. That's the original sin, believe it or not. What is the book of Genesis really telling us about? Is the Garden of Eden story talking about our creation? Or is it talking about the moment that God was able to look at himself through the cosmic fracture? That's exactly what it's talking about, by the way. And this is why the Gnostics actually saw the serpent in the Garden of Eden as a good thing. Because if you think about the Garden of Eden story, it's a little bit it's a little bit skewed the wrong way. I mean, Adam didn't get a bad, I mean, really, the punishment was a little severe for what happened there. Yeah, it was disobedience, and that's what they're trying to teach you there. But the problem is they were tricked into it. It wasn't a completely clean choice. The serpent does trick them, and the serpent was there prior to them getting it, which meant that there was a condition of evil already.
Amen.
It's true. You know, and so that wasn't our fault. But yet, why was there punishment in the theology, in the conventional story? Why was there punishment? Because we disobeyed what we were told to do. Do not eat. You do everything you want. Don't eat of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil. Why is the fruit of knowledge of good and evil? Oh, could it be the knowledge of the contrast between yin and yang? Duality. We, at that point, learned that we could see the cosmos, and we fractured it through the perceptive faculties of awareness. At that point, awareness became consciousness. At that point, compassion became love. At that point, intention became erroneous notions of free will, choices that don't really matter in the grand cosmic scheme of things. You can't change the universe with your actions. Yeah, I mean, you can go and kill a whole bunch of people. That's a horrible thing. But guess what? The universe still goes on. ISIS has been killing people horribly for several years now. And, I mean, the universe will outlive ISIS. In fact, they're already starting to fall apart. You know, that kind of energy burns out really quick. So it's not too troublesome to the cosmos. It's worrisome to us because we're in the archetypal story. We don't want our heroes to die. So death is horrible to us. But it's not, the universe doesn't care about that. Cosmos, it lives on. It's eternal. And we're just thought bubbles. Little shadows that get cast on the ether. That's all we are. The singularity. Okay, so what do we learn about in the scriptures? And I have to use the Christian worldview because that's where the developed idea of Satan comes from. You know, the other religions don't really have Satan in the same way. Even these Muslims don't really have a Satan like we do. They have the jinn, demonic creatures and stuff, but it's not quite like what we have. And even Judaism doesn't care about the devil. It's not relevant to them. It's a Christian thing. Jesus dies on the cross for atonement for the sins of Adam and Eve so that he can correct the universe, right? That death on the cross, what does that do? It's complete eradication of the ego reality. It's willfully accepting death for the sake of all. In fact, the Orthodox Church has a wonderful thing that says, God became man so that man could become God. The Orthodox Church lives by that. They call that process of knowledge theosis, the process of divinizing mankind. It's important because we see, you know, the Christian worldview sees itself as sinful and not worthy. In reality, what the theology of the church is teaching is God is raising you up to his level, not to some level below him, raising you all the way up to the level of God. Even St. Paul says he's made us little less than gods. Because why? We have the shadow abilities of God. God produces compassion, but we have the ability to produce love, which is a little bit like it. God produces intention. We have the ability to make choices. Not big ones, because we're not ready yet, but big ones, nonetheless, for us. And God has the ability to have awareness. He can observe the creation. We experience consciousness, a certain sense of self-awareness. Isn't it? It's wild. So when you think about Jesus dying on the cross, what he's really doing is he's shedding humanity of its corruptions. That produces, that in reality is where Satan came from. Satan is what happens when God, theologically now, talking conventional truth, God becomes man. So that man can become God, God has to enter into our sinful flesh, but he's not sinful, he's too perfect. So what happens? He has to push everything sinful that's in humanity out, creates the devil. That's where the devil comes from. That's where the devil comes from for you. When a person becomes possessed, it's a fracture in their psyche. What does the word psychology mean? You know where it comes from, the word psyche? Greek word psyche? It means spirit. The spiritual world is the world of the mind. When the spiritual fractures and you have good and evil, you create the conditions inside yourself to experience angels and demons. But it's because it's conventional, it's still true. You cannot say that the person's story, the experience that they have with the angel is, oh, it's not real, they're just, it's delusions. No, it's not delusions. It's the way the universe interacts with us. It's the way the universe talks to us through those stories. Which is why, let's get really graphic here for a minute. All right? It would be unbecoming of a priest to say, but let's talk about this. If you went to the park and saw two people having sex on a park bench, think about what your reactions would be. Probably a little bit of disgust, maybe a little bit of shock, maybe you'd laugh at it. You might say, they need to get a room. But yet we will never hesitate to go to a movie that has the most incredible love scene, and we might even cry through it. Why does the story make it okay, but the real life we don't like to see? And that's because we respond to the archetypes that are contained within the story. It makes it okay, because we're influenced by those archetypes. And that creates our reality. And so yes, when you have a divine experience, when you experience God, you have a vision, you see an angel, you see a demon, you become possessed, it's real. At the conventional level, the absolute level is there's a fracture within the psyche, and we are nothing more than just a combination of all sorts of thoughts and ideas that come together, and we think we know who we are. But we're never the same from one moment to the next. I guarantee you, when you were 6 years old, you're not who you are today.
Right.
You're always changing. And that's because we're mutable. We're not real. Eternal things last forever. That's the singularity, that's God, that's the unidirectional motion of the cosmos, that's evolution. That's the reality. The story of Jesus Christ is the process to going from a reflection of a reflection to casting the reflection itself. God becomes man so that man can become God. So you might say, why can't science find God? Well, maybe because God doesn't fully exist yet. To us, he doesn't. We're in the process of becoming that reality. God exists outside of time. We're stuck in linear time. So we see the process and it seems painfully slow. Even the church says, Jesus by the cross already defeated Satan. Jesus by the cross already defeated Satan. So why do we still have evil in the world? Why? Because the process hasn't been completed yet. From God's vantage point, it's done. Now let me really blow your minds. What do you expect to have happen when you die? Think about what's going to happen when you die. If you have an afterlife, who believes in an afterlife? So raise your hand if you believe in an afterlife. Okay. So what do you think is going to happen? You think you're going to see your relatives maybe? See God? See maybe relatives that have died before you? What if I were to tell you that it exists outside of time? The church has taught that God's timeless. So the kingdom of heaven is timeless. So if it's timeless, guess what? You're going to go and you meet yourself. You're already there. You're already there. You just haven't realized it yet. So what is life? Life is realizing that you're already in the kingdom of heaven. That's the reality of it. You just haven't realized it. So what is all of this? This is realization. That's all the universe is. You might say, what's the meaning of life? Life is realizing. That's it. It never was meant to be anything more than that. And if you look and read the ancient stories, like the Garden of Eden story, that's all it's about. It's about realizing of the self. And it is earth-shattering if you let it be. It really is. It will change you. It will awaken you. You wake up and you say, I get it now. And all of the contradictions in religion and all of the wars that take place in the world over theological ideas will make sense to you. And even all the science that contradicts it all and says, it's because they don't understand how important stories are to us. Think about when you're a child. Did you want to hear long, boring dissertations about the operations of the universe, and did you want to hear stories? What put you to bed at night? What made you feel safe? The stories that your mom or dad maybe told you when you were a kid. The stories that you heard, maybe your teacher. Maybe it's something you watched on TV that, and you still feel it. Think about when you go to a movie, it's something that's sad, it makes you cry. But in real life, it probably won't make you cry that much. It might not be all that dramatic in real life. The drama makes it somehow more real, and yet it's less real, supposedly. No, the archetypes are actually real. We are not. This story, this virtual reality that we call reality, is not real. What's real are the archetypes that produce it. Now let me give you an experience with that, and we can close up. So get out your papers from the beginning, and we're going to look at this, and you're going to really see things about yourself. Okay. You were asleep for a long time. That represents this primordial condition. And then you woke up and you were in the woods. You weren't sure where you were, but you found yourself in the woods and you looked around and you saw the woods. The woods are an archetype. The archetype represents your image of the world. That's how you see the world. So if you saw a very dark, foreboding forest, then you see the world as a very dark and foreboding place, archetypally. And you might say, I don't know. I'm not sure I can accept that. Pay attention to what it's telling you, because that was your first impression. You know, and you don't want to let your ego reality, your beliefs about who you want yourself to be, to influence what you're actually experiencing archetypally, because that's how you control the archetypes, and that's how you enter into the eternal life that Jesus talks about. Okay? So the forest was, so anyone want to share their forest? Anyone want to tell me, what did you see?
I seen green trees, green rays, big blue sky.
So then your view of the world is actually a very positive and optimistic. You probably see that there's danger and there's horrible things that happen, but ultimately deep down, you love life. And that's what it says. That's what it means. Archetypally, it means you're actually a very, you know, very good and solid person, stable. That's a wonderful thing. You know, you want to see a lot of green, you want to see sunshine, you saw blue sky, that's really good. Carl Jung would have said, oh yeah, you're operating on a whole higher level than most people. That's a good thing. I like that one. Okay, so you continued your journey and you found a key on the ground. Who wants to share what they did with it and what it looked like? Anybody?
I did a metallic blue key and I put it in my pocket.
Metallic blue key and put it in your pocket? I'm sure you're going to relate to this. That is the archetype for how you perceive knowledge. So knowledge is something that, blue is sort of a mystical color. It's sort of a mysterious color. And so you tend to see knowledge as something that is to be discovered, and the fact that you took it with you means that you embrace. You don't shun anything. You want to be able to experience as much. You thirst for knowledge. Some people throw the key away.
Wow.
They tend to be people that are very repressive.
Yes.
So it's a very good. That's again a very good answer. That's something that Carl Jung would say. What they use these projection tests for, by the way, is they use it to try to see if they could find what Carl Jung called neuroses. We don't really use that word in psychology anymore, but it was a big word at the time, and you would see like neurological complications. Yes. We did a little exercise. It was a visualization, and I took everybody in the class at the beginning through and had them write down what they saw in their minds as I told them a story. And so when I said you found the key on the ground, I had everybody look down in their minds and see the key and say, okay, now write down what you saw and what it looked like and what you go to.
What if you walk past it? Because you know the key that don't belong to you, it ain't gonna work for you, just walk past it.
It means there's things in your life that you're likely avoiding, things that you would prefer not to know about. certain challenges, certain things in your life that are obstacles, and you would rather avoid learning about them and ignoring them than having to integrate them and deal with them, which can sometimes be too painful. That's what typically it means if you pass the key by. If you throw the key, really look out.
I took that key and I opened the door.
Oh, that's wonderful. That means that you're...
And I'm just coming in late, too.
Yeah.
I'm going, as you're making this...
Oh, yeah, you can. I mean, I'm going to go through. You can try to see what
and
you
I,
get.
And I picked the key up and opened the door. I don't know where the door came from. It didn't matter to me. But I opened the door. So what's that?
I'm gonna let me get back to your answer because there's another part of this story that might answer that.
Okay.
All right.
That's good.
That's actually one of the best things you can do is take it and open a door. It's one of the best things you can do, and I'll explain in a minute. All right. The next thing you did is you found a vase on the ground. Who wants to share what they saw and what you see?
It was made of cobalt glass, blue
glass.
Okay. With me in case I came across some flowers.
Okay, good. That's very good. That's your image of an ideal mate. It's how you would see the image of, or how you treat your most intimate relationships. And so in this particular sense, again, blue being a cool color, representing somebody that you want, that you would see in your life as being somebody that's gentle, and kind versus you wouldn't enjoy an aggressive person, and the curves and the shapes can represent actually a complex person. You want somebody that's multidimensional. You don't want someone that's flat. You want someone who's interesting. And the fact that you take it with you means you have a strong capacity for lifelong relationships.
Wow.
That you don't throw them away too easily.
Good.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a really very 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 good one. Then you came to the wall. This is where the trouble begins. Who wants to talk about the wall? Anybody?
I just hopped up on it.
Oh, you hopped on it?
Yeah.
Okay. What did it look like? Was it tall? Was it short?
It was about, I couldn't see over it.
Okay.
It was rectangular brick.
Okay. Was it clean? Was it dirty?
It was clean.
Okay.
And I just like stepped back and I hopped up on it.
And you got over it?
You just
got on top of it and looked around.
Yeah.
Okay. That's how you face problems.
Wow.
So that means you're actually you encounter problems. In fact, you encounter a lot of problems that you don't necessarily have the immediate solution for, but you find the solution. You might not necessarily act on it because you like to stop and you contemplate for a while. But you will get up there and you'll scope around that, and maybe you didn't see a reason to scale the wall. Maybe you realize that this isn't a problem I have to be dealing with. But you took the time to contemplate it, to consider it, and it wasn't insurmountable to you. If you could climb up on the wall, you could have climbed over the wall. That's a really good answer, too. That's a good one. Okay, after the wall, we found that our path was blocked by water. Anybody want to share the water? Yes.
I saw a small stream, clear and not deep. I walk through.
Okay. And you walk through it?
I walk.
Okay. Prepare to laugh a little bit. This one's a funny one. This is your archetypal view on sexuality. So the fact that you saw a small and shallow pool, but it was very clear, you don't like nonsense.
No.
You don't like sexual nonsense. You like a very clean and intimate relationship that is probably very pure and traditional in that respect. And walking through it means that you're very comfortable with your own sexuality. It doesn't frighten you. It doesn't scare you. You're not, you don't find it to be something to be ashamed of. Walking through it is actually the thing that Jung would have looked for. He would have wanted you to walk through it. Freud was very sexually obsessed anyway. So, you know, if you walked away from the pool, he'd be worried about you. Yeah. So that's the archetypal view of sexuality. The bear comes next, and there's a reason the bear comes while you're in the water. I'll explain that when we get through it. Who wants to share their bear? What you see?
Actually, what I saw was that it was originally a wild bear that actually became friendly and you start petting it.
God, you guys have such healthy minds! The bear is your attitude towards death. So you're not afraid of death. In fact, when it comes, you'll embrace it. You might not necessarily want to deal with it, but you will not be somebody who's terrified or, you know, will have all sorts of challenges with having to integrate your own demise when you face that one day, which is very good. And so that's, if it wasn't terribly scary, if it even became sort of a friend, it's a good sign. The reason that the bear comes after sexuality, the water, is because in the archetypal system that Carl Jung created, the actual opposite of death is not life and is not birth, it's sex. And so sexuality, what he saw as the creative principle, and death was the reabsorption principle. And so the fact that you would engage the water means that you, in order to engage sex, you must engage death as well, because they are two sides of the exact same coin, which explains why we have such hang-ups about death, just like we have hang-ups about, hang-ups about sexuality, just like we have hang-ups about death. The two things that you never hear people wanting to talk too much about with strangers, or even with people that you know well, family members, you don't want to ever talk about sex, you never want to talk about death. Those are really private things, and that's why. Because they hit a little too close to home, to the reality of our existence, so we tend to stay away from them. Okay, you came to, this is going to get back to what you said about opening the door. The next thing you do is come to a house. So who wants to talk about their house?
This is when I use the key.
Okay, so you did. You went through. A lot of people go through the door with the key. I don't know if you would have done it if you had been there.
Yeah, I don't know.
But it could be the same. It could be the house.
It
could be the same house. What does your house look like?
It's wood.
Wood? Was it big, small?
It was in between. It was like a cabin.
Okay. Simple?
Yes, simple.
The house is your concept of your own self. The fact that you went into the door with the key means that you know yourself and you understand yourself very well. You know who you are. You understand that self-identity that we talk about. There's no mysteries in that regard. You're very secure, self-secure, and you're very confident within who you are. You don't let other people define that for you, which is a very good thing. That's also an extremely good answer. I'm surprised I'm not getting any neurotic answers here. This is good. We got a good group. Probably means that there's a lot more to you than meets the eye. Shannon can testify to that. okay. And the last one was when you found the breaking in the woods up ahead, it led to a road. Who wants to talk about the road?
Anyone? I didn't have a road.
What did you have?
Nothing.
There was nothing up there. Interesting.
I could not visualize a road.
Interesting. I've never heard that one before. That's actually a neurotic answer, but I'm going to answer that. What did you say?
After leaving the house, dirt road appeared.
Dirt road, okay.
And it was long. Trees was on, like, no side. So I was, like, looking for direction to, like, find the right way, go left or right.
Did you finally make that decision, or did you just stop there?
I stopped.
Did you stop, Charlie?
I looked around. I mean, it was.
But you didn't go down the road. You said there wasn't a road, so
there was no road.
So did you just stop there in your mind? There was nothing else to do.
Well, I was just looking around. Behind me, there was a lake and a wall and the house.
Okay, so you could still see the other objects.
Yeah, everything else was still around me.
And you were trying to decide where to go.
Which way to go, right, left?
Okay, you had the same experience.
Well, a little different. I too saw a country road, and I just started walking north. Eventually, I would find my way out.
Okay, that's actually the best, one of the best answers. Was it a big road? Is it a highway?
No, it was a red clay country road.
Okay, country road. Okay, what'd you say?
He said it was small and rocky.
Okay.
And my feet were hurting. I sat down.
Okay. The road is your archetypal image of the future.
Wow.
That's how you see the future.
Rocky? My road
was like the sea. Oh, lots of twists and turns. Lots of peril. Yeah.
Oh, no, not peril.
It doesn't mean there's going to be peril. It just means that you expect there.
And then there will.
Yeah.
Because you expect it.
Yeah, that's true. We sometimes create our own problems.
There you go.
Charlie, you just basically, you don't have an image of the future. You don't project that far ahead. You live day to day. You're very a now person. And that's what it means. And as far as you like making the choice, you like to make careful decisions. So maybe you tend to hold yourself back a little bit when moving forward. Who was it that went, actually, you got on the road and started traveling, right?
Yeah.
So that's the best answer. That's, you actually face the future coming on. You're not afraid of it. You roll with the punches, as they say. These things express how we interact with archetypes, or better yet, how archetypes interact with us. So they create our world. We don't create their world. I feel like we create stories. You know, J.K. Rowling thinks that she created Harry Potter. Harry Potter created her. Our stories are given to us. And there is a certain element of decision making that we have. That's the empowerment. But the reason there's a fail-safe like this is because, once again, let's get back into our conventional Christian story about the devil. The reason we are limited is because if, in the archetypal story, it's true that God became man so that man could become God, then what that essentially means is we're in the process of being that ultimate force in the cosmic process of all things. Do you feel ready to take on that responsibility now? Of course not. You're too limited. Think of yourself as in a womb. Just like a unborn child is merely just an image, a shadow of what it will become. It's just raw potential. Doesn't make it any less a life. In fact, it's probably perhaps one of the most important lives in the world. We don't know. But we can say with great certainty that that unborn child is raw potential. It hasn't gestated yet. And even once it's born, there's a certain period of time before it reaches maturity that it can take on the responsibilities of adulthood. We're in that process right now. We are in the womb still. We haven't been born. In fact, I'll leave you with this story and I'll take the questions. It's one of a Buddhist story. I might have told it last time. I don't think I did. But if I did, tell me. But it's really very relevant in many cases, and it's nice to reflect upon now. There's a Buddhist monk and his novice that he's training. And they spend day after day in meditation and prayer doing the things that Buddhist monks do up in the Himalayas. And behind the monastery is this great giant mountain. And it overlooks, almost in a protective way, the monastery. And the novice likes to go out there and look at it every now and then. One day he goes out there and he's thinking about his life as a monk. He's like, what is this all for? I'm not really achieving anything. I'm not doing anything. I'm just meditating all day. What am I doing here? What is this all about? So he goes with this problem to his master and says, you know, master, I'm not sure why I'm doing this. You know, what is this all about? Why are we here? Why do we meditate all day? And he says, he says, my son, you know, we do this so that we can achieve to enlightenment. You know, in that way we can awaken to the truth. And he says, but what does that mean? He says, well, when you awaken to the truth, then you understand. And he says, okay, so let's say I do all the meditation that I need to do, you know, and then I eventually awaken to enlightenment. What happens next? After that, and he says, well, he says, then you take the vow of the bodhisattva. What's that? He says. He says, well, that's when you agree that you will not move on to nirvana, which is the state of complete bliss and no longer any suffering, no longer any, you know, pure awakening. You will go on to nirvana. You will hold yourself back from going on to nirvana until every other living being gets there first. In other words, you will keep coming back lifetime after lifetime until you have helped every single soul get to nirvana. Every blade of grass, every living thing has to achieve to nirvana first, and then you're done. He says, well, what happens after that? Let's say I do that. How long is that going to take? And so the master says, well, it takes 3 immeasurable eons. He says, well, how long is an immeasurable eon? He says, well, you see that mountain out back? He says, take my kata. Katas are like a very thin white scarf that they use for ceremonial purposes in the Vajrayana school of Buddhism. And he takes the scarf and he says, take it out to the base of that mountain out back. This is the Himalayas. These are the biggest mountains in the world. And he says, every 100 years, you get to go up to the base of that mountain and brush the scarf against the edge of it just one time. And he says, when you have worn that mountain down to the size of a pebble, one immeasurable eon has not yet passed. And he says, and I have to do 3 of them? And he says, yes, you have to do 3. He says, okay, so I meditate. I achieve to enlightenment. I take the Bodhisattva vow. I go out to the base of the mountain every 100 years and wipe the kata across the edge, and I wear it down 3 times. What happens next? And he says, that, my son, is when you can begin. And so the point of that is, we're in gestation. The reason we don't know things, the reason we don't understand everything, the reason why we're so limited on our faculties of awareness, and we struggle with whose religion is right, and whether or not science is you know, has a right to intervene with what we believe in religion. The reason we struggle with these things is because we don't understand what our purpose is yet. As soon as we get beyond the paradigms and the biases and see things the way they actually are, as close as we can get to it, because remember, you can never really cross that line into actuality, but you can stay in absolute truth. As soon as you achieve to the point where you're at the mystical point of awakening, where you can see both sides equally of conventional and absolute truth, when you can integrate them both. It's not enough. It's not enough to have one. All scientists have a conventional truth. All religious people have a conventional truth. All agnostics have a conventional truth. All atheists have a conventional truth. That's just their story. It's not a better story. It just is a story. But until they can stand at that mystical point of awakening and look at their own story and see things a little bit more accurately the way they really are, you still live in delusion. And you can never achieve to beyond that until you get past that point and you integrate them both. So the most successful individuals on the process of awareness have a solid belief system that they utilize for the purposes of conventional truth, never as an imposition on anyone else, never as a dogmatism. Dogmatism is completely out of the question. Doctrine's okay, but dogmatism, not at all. You can say that just consciousness is the accident of awareness, you can say that dogmatism is the accident of doctrine. When we start to push our beliefs on other people.
Right.
Can't do that. Because then it infringes upon their truth system. And they need to discover it for themselves. But you need both. You need to be able to see things objectively like a scientist, and you also have to integrate your own story, whatever that might be. And a good story that understands this whole process will get you there a lot faster. So, you know, I think Catholic Christianity is a great way for that, because it has the immortality rites of the sacraments. It has the theology of eternal life and salvation. And it gives us a story that we can utilize to activate those cosmic principles in our life to achieve to the immortality that it promises by creating a pattern that is forever existing and becomes part of this original condition. For science, well, theoretical physics might be the best story for them, because theoretical physics allows for there to be room for a God, even though it doesn't want to call it that. That's why we used the word cosmos before. But, I mean, any theoretical physicist is going to tell you that to assume this universe spawned into the order that it is by some type of freak accident is possible. Because when you start to break things down at the subatomic level where things really get strange, you see that there's great intention behind it. I can give you a quick example. Take, for example, the atoms that make up this chair. Okay, they have observed, using really interesting equipment that goes beyond my understanding, they've observed that they can take a look at these atoms that make up and go down to the subatomic particles, which would get you into the protons and the neutrons and electrons that bind the thing together to make it feel like it's solid, because it's really not solid. This is an energy field. You know what? You really can't touch anything? Do you know you can't touch anything? I can't even touch you.
My God.
If I were to go to touch your face, I would be touching the energy field on your face. I would not be able to touch your atoms. Atoms cannot touch. They would implode. But there's an energy field that they give off through their electrical fields. That's what we're actually touching, and we think it's real. There's actually a lot of holes here, but the energy field makes it feel solid, okay? But they've observed that when you get down to those subatomic particles, and you're not looking at them anymore, they disappear. They go this direction, that direction, they go hide over here, they go in the same place at the same time. Two particles existing, coexisting at the same point in space. And then as soon as you look at it again, oh, they go back, form the chair. So what that means is, reality only is real as long as somebody's looking at it, as long as somebody's observing it. This is theoretical physics. This is no religion. This is no metaphysical kind of crazy new age, you know, thinking. This is theoretical physicists. Some of the brightest minds at Michio Kaku, who we had the opportunity to interview on one of our podcasts once. You know, great mind. Coming up with this stuff. Einstein would have been at this level if he was alive today. He was just starting with this. That's what Satan is. It's what's left behind when we get rid of what we don't like about ourselves. So the Satan, the demons that you interact with in your life, are nothing more than just aspects of yourself that you have rejected. If you want to get rid of them, the only way to exorcise them is through integration. That doesn't mean that you accept them as what they are. It means that you accept them for what they're not. They are not your identity. That's how I fix people from demonic possession. Now, I use the sword. I use the rite of exorcism. I use liturgy. I use prayer, holy water. Those are all the tools of the story. Those are all the characters in this story. And they work because the stories are more real than the people. So, yes. Rite of exorcism, absolutely effective. But what I'm really doing behind the scenes, what they don't really see, what they don't really know, is I'm just integrating their story back from its fragmented state. So our demons are really just aspects of ourselves that we would prefer did not exist. Satan is Jesus' carryover when he assumed man. Because he had to enter into our sinful nature. What does Paul say? God, I can't remember how the verse goes. He became sin for us. He who knew no sin became sin for us. That's a really confusing verse for people. He who knew no sin became sin for us. What does it mean Jesus became sin? Jesus didn't become sin. Jesus entered into sin. That had to go somewhere. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. And so the carryover for him is Satan, which is why they both can call themselves the star of the morning, which is why we have Shahar as the Venus in the dawn, and we have Shalim as Venus in the dusk. And they're both the same, two sides of the same coin. There is no evil, you see. You know, the real devil, the actual devil, the devil of the Old Testament, the devil is an aspect of God's reabsorption principle. We don't like reabsorption because it hurts. We like to live. Because we're ectropic. We are on the evolutionary scale. We understand intuitively that we want to go from simple form to complex form. And we have this instinct that we should live forever.
Right.
This is why every religion tries to give you immortality in some form or fashion. And that's why, because that's our instinct. Our instinct is this, even though we're like, but we die. We die anyway. That doesn't change. Well, of course it doesn't change, because we're still, our bodies are still entropic. They will die, I can assure you of that. Science might be able to come up with some little ways to trick the process, but I guarantee you when we do, our spiritual evolution is going to skyrocket. And then science and religion will be far more together than they are apart as they are now. But that's what Satan is. That's the reality of it. So it's not something to shun as much as it's something to integrate. Doesn't mean you make friends with him.
Right.
It means that you put him in his proper place. Mm. You have command over the darkness in your life. You really do.
Yes.
You really do. And you do that through the gifts that God has given you,
right,
which is your faculties of awareness. That's it. Any questions?
I really don't have a question, but it's more of an example of a spiritual warfare I had in my home.
Okay.
Where this spirit was messing with my daughter, but she never said anything to me about it. But later on, it started messing with me. But I didn't know nothing about it. It had been messing with her.
Yeah.
So at the service one night, what happened was I was laying on the sofa in my den, and it just laid across me, and I was paralyzed. Like, I couldn't move. I was asleep, but I was conscious at the same time. And then I realized that it was an unclean spirit, so I began in my mind to say the blood. But the more I would try to open my mouth to speak it, it was trying to close my mouth so I couldn't open my mouth to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Then once I was saying the blood, it was whispering in my ear and it was saying my name. It was speaking my name. So once I got to the point where I was wrestling with it for a while, but once I began to call Jesus, it really started like trying to close my mouth.
Like got angry.
Yes, and so finally I got Jesus out,
mm-hmm,
and it just loosed me. But I had talked to my daughter about her situation. So after service, she just all of a sudden, she just said, Mom, I need to talk to you. We was riding, going home. And she was like, it's a spirit, I believe, Mom, that's been messing with me in my room.
Yeah.
It was the same thing she was telling me about that I had encountered. But I got so upset because I felt like it was invading my privacy in my home. It was torturing us. And I'm like, you know, spirit of fear had like, so I went and I binded it in the name of Jesus. We haven't had that problem anymore, but you know, once when I seen the flower and stuff like that, I was like, oh, but it's not the first time I have had encounter with spirits or seen spirits or, because all of them are not the same shape. Like, I see some human forms.
Yeah.
Some I see like shapes. Some like real quick, like lightning. But I have had like dreams where I can't even describe if they were like gray, black, and white. And it was like a whole bunch of them connected. But anyway, it was just, for me, it was more interesting when I seen this class, and I was like, I'm going to go to this class. And, but I guess I've been dealing with spirits since I was little.
You sound like what we would call, in this work, a sensitive. And, you know, that some people call it a medium. In the, if you want to use purely Christian vernacular, I would say it's the gift of discernment. And that is the ability to interact with spiritual forces. Now, one of the things I didn't have time to get into One of these other aspects of the yin and yang principles that make up is that one side of the cosmos is corporeal, and one side of the cosmos is incorporeal or non-corporeal. Okay, what that means is there's aspects of our universe that are physical. We can interact with them. We can feel them. They're objective, and we can, we can all agree that we all agree this is a podium. You know, we're all rational minds. We can look at this podium, and we don't question that it's a bed or a lobster dinner. We know, we can all agree, it's consistently a podium. That's corporeal. But there's another side of the cosmos that is completely non-corporeal. And we have that nature too. Our corporeal side we call our body. Our non-corporeal side we call our spirit. And spiritual forces are of the non-corporeal operations of the universe. Okay? So when you're interacting with that, remember what the word psyche means, which is the word we get psychology from. It is spirit. It means spirit or soul even. But I mean, I use the word soul for a completely different thing. And so you're having interactions because you're very sensitive to the non-corporeal side of things. And so you're going to have a more creative and somewhat more spectacular experience with the universe than somebody who's more geared towards observing the corporeal side. And so the corporeal side of nature is where you find a lot of science people. They are more comfortable there. Problem is, somewhere along the lines, people get the idea in the modern world, it was never a problem until recently actually, that what if it happens in your mind, it's not real. What happens out here is real.
Right.
No.
Right.
The mind is just as real. Everything that goes on inside your mind is just as real as everything that goes on out here. The only difference is we can't see what's going on in your mind, typically.
Right.
Unless you're having a dramatic spiritual event, like your daughter being able to experience an entity and you experience it too. And that happens a lot. That's where a lot of the root of hauntings comes from. We deal with hauntings as well. And that's all part of the non-corporeal side. Now you might say, oh, but that's a lot of garbage. All that is real is the physical world. Well, guess what? I mean, again, we thank God for theoretical physicists, because they've determined that there's this whole amount of space, a larger amount of space in the universe, that shouldn't be there. And we don't know what it is. We call it dark matter now.
Right.
But we don't know what dark matter is. Dark matter is the product of the non-corporeal aspect of the universe. And that's where all of the spiritual things that happen are taking place in there. But they don't see it yet, because they're not at that level yet. They're not able to observe outside of their paradigm. This is what I'm trying to say, that even though someone is a scientist, doesn't mean they're not living by a story. They're still living by a story. It's not a religious story. It's a concrete, objective story. But does it make it any more able to see the reality yet? Or I should say, actuality. They have to have both sides working. Just like you have a left side of your hemisphere, your brain, your right side of your brain. The left side deals with rational thinking, objectivity, math. Right side's the creative, artistic, intuitive. Yin and yang again. Not good and evil. Yin and yang. It's balanced. And the universe maintains this perpetual balance. So I'd say, well, why do bad things happen to good people?
Wow.
The reason that bad things happen is because we don't like them. We don't want to die. So okay, if some ISIS comes in and slices your head off, that's kind of, we don't like that. So we're gonna categorize that. We're gonna say that's evil. And it is. It's of the, in the conventional vantage point, it is evil. It's of the darkness. But cosmically speaking, it keeps the balance. That's why it's a lot better. What does God say? What was that original verse that we talked about? One of the first ones? It was, I can find it again. It was Isaiah 45:7. I form the light and create the darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all things. Yeah, why? Cosmic balance keeps things cohesive. He's creating a perfect picture for his art class. The photograph of life must be perfectly contrasted. so it doesn't wash out and it doesn't get too dark, and you can see the picture and understand the picture. So it's a good composition. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah.
One word that I saw that was missing from the whole thing, and I think I understand, or at least partially understand why, is the word hell, or the concept of hell, as far as, you know, in the afterlife, because of course with the it took man, for man to become God, but there was no mention of the other side.
Okay. That's a loaded question, so I'll try to be as concise as I can. What does Jesus, there was no concept of hell in the Old Testament. There was Sheol. Sheol was not a place of punishment, it was a place of sleep, eternal sleep, unconsciousness. The Greek version was Hades.
Yes.
Okay, and then it gets translated to English as hell. There was no place of punishment until the Middle Ages. The church didn't even have one. But we hear Jesus talking about these horrible torments, right? He calls them the fires of Gehenna, right? What was Gehenna? Does anyone know? I'm sure you probably know what Gehenna is. Gehenna is the trash dump outside of the walls of Jerusalem where people who lived in Jerusalem went to throw their trash to get rid of it. What wasn't there? It wasn't a place that they tortured people. It was a place to get rid of the junk that you don't need. Let me read another verse. I had a feeling this question was going to come up. That's why I actually prepared for this stuff. Here you go. Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30. It's the parable of the weeds and the wheat. Let me read it to you. This will explain your question in a nutshell. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you are pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring them into my barn." That's Jesus' parable from his own mouth about heaven and hell. Hell is not a place of torment. Hell is a place of annihilation. If you don't create the permanent pattern that allows you to supersede the process of entropy, then you should simply get reabsorbed and recycled. That's why the Eastern religions have a theology of reincarnation, because they see this. But it's not the same person going on to lifetime. It's the energy that person had that animated them going on. Their aggregate structure, which is their attributes. I might be 7% compassionate. I might be 21% hateful. I might be 35% intelligent. These are my attributes. Intelligence is eternal. It will live on. It lived on before me. It will live on after me. Compassion's eternal. It will always exist as long as there's intelligence in the universe, which is the substance of what the universe is. It's awareness. It's intelligent. Okay? So, if I don't create a permanent pattern, which in the Christian conventional truth is salvation, going to heaven, then I end up in hell. I get reabsorbed, not punished, just simply my energy gets disassembled, it breaks down, gets reassembled into a new person. And I might even contain some of the impressions and memories of that one that had the energy before me. And that's sometimes when people think I have a past life memory, that's what they're really experiencing. But it's not really them. It was just somebody else that had your energy at one time. It's just the energy can't be destroyed, so it gets regenerated. But you can create a permanent pattern. And that's what immortality essentially is. So when you hear about immortality rites in Taoism, the immortality rites of ancient Egypt, the eternal life of Christianity, that's what you're talking about. You're talking about creating a permanent pattern that can transcend this process of entropy and enter into an ectropic reality, which is the reality where you go from things going from being impermanent to things being naturally permanent. That's the kingdom of heaven. So when Jesus says, I will, you know, at the end of time, there will be a new heaven and a new earth, he's not talking about some other place. He's talking about converting, twisting this universe inside out so it goes from entropy to ectropy. And then we live forever. And then there is no death anymore. There is. It's just like the stories are. If you lived in an ectropic universe, it would be paradise because you wouldn't have suffering. As soon as you get sick, the sickness would eventually immediately turn into health instead of you getting sicker and needing some kind of medicine to get you better. You have to intervene here, otherwise you die. That's it. It's interesting, isn't it?
Yes.
But it's the way things really are. And you can still, it doesn't conflict with your chosen religion. Every religion can use this information. It's just everyone has a little bit of a different side of it. And I include science in that. I do. I include science in that because that's part of our story. They have their own part of that story. They observe the objective reality very well. They use a scientific method of observation, and they draw very concrete and reliable and repeatable examples of what they choose to believe in. Religion doesn't have that benefit because it's more non-corporeal. So it's not as cohesive. It changes. Just like the subatomic particles. Yes, it has been established by theoretical physics. When we all leave this room will no longer be here until somebody decides to walk into it again, and then all of a sudden it, poof, it's back. It's in a virtual reality.
Would the first diaphragm, the first DNA before the DNA?
Uh-huh.
Number one.
Yeah.
Would that be what the CERN machine?
Oh, okay.
And the God particle are searching for?
In a sense, it's searching for the information that's currently contained about the present universe as its primordial condition. Yes. So what they're trying to discover is what existed before the Big Bang? What was here? Or what was, I mean, it's not even a here, because you're talking about time and space being spawned at the same time. So yes, they are trying to figure out using that very sophisticated piece of equipment, what might have occurred right before the Big Bang, to see if there was anything existent. But I think, you know, if you really break down what the mystics have taught, what the esoteric mystery schools have taught, and what theoretical physics is now catching up to, you see that what just happened is that universes come into being and they come out of being and they come into being and they come out of being indefinitely.
Right.
They're just, like I said, I call it the breath of God. He inhales, he exhales, and then that's it. We become part of that process if we do the work of salvation. For Christians, that's what we would call it. I mean, for Buddhists, they would call it enlightenment. For science, I guess you could say it would be discovering the secrets to living forever using some type of concrete objective formula. But they're going to learn that that's not going to work until you start to get beyond the physicality.
Right.
They'll have to engage the non-corporeal before they can achieve that.
Right.
And once they do that, they'll have it.
Right. And that's just like saying, because what I explain to people is that our Bible is twofold. It's carnal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's spiritual.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You have to come from being carnal,
right,
operating in the natural flesh, to operate in a spiritual flesh,
yes,
in order to get to the spirituality that God is calling to.
Exactly. That's exactly accurate. Yeah, that's exactly right. It's to be able to, it's a navigation. It's how to navigate both sides of that,
yes,
world. Both of these. We spend a lot of our time over here in the yang, where everything's physical and rational and objective and consistent. We spend very little time over here because we've marginalized it. It's just not, just now psychologists are starting to see the value of child's play. Play is so
important. Oh my God, you just did not know what you just This is something that I just had a battle with this week.
Oh, really?
In school about children playing.
Yeah.
It is not bullying, it's child play.
Yeah.
And it's important to the development of our kids, the innocent level, where they're at in comparison to where we're at.
Yeah.
And where we need to go.
Yeah.
Where we need to get back to. You opened up a big old thing right there. You throw me off track.
Well, that's fine.
But I can go back to it. The Lord showed me, so in the beginning, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, he said, actually, there should be a period right there. It should not even go on to everything else without stopping and understanding in the beginning. But in the beginning, I'm going to be number one or above number one.
In the beginning would be, in the beginning is, yeah, I would have to say that is just before number two.
Number two.
So it's probably somewhere like right here. Because what we get is, in the beginning, if you did put a period there and you didn't go on to God created the heavens and the earth, which is, this is what this is. This is why in the Taoist system, Yang is called the heavens, Yin is called the earth. That's why. And it's like the I Ching is an example of heaven and earth polarities. And so God created the heaven and the earth right here is before that all happens. So in the beginning, yeah, you could say that that's the last part of number one. But it really, it's all timeless. So there isn't really a cycle here that you can say this is when it started and this is where it's going. You can't measure that. Because it's all happening outside. Just like I said, what's going to surprise most people is that when you finally do achieve to the kingdom of heaven, you're going to awaken to already having been there. And this is merely just the memory of before you got there. So you're kind of, right now, what you're doing is you're remembering. You're remembering so that you can awaken. You're not entirely here. And that's why this place doesn't feel entirely real sometimes.
Yes, yes, yes.
If you really pay attention, non-corporeal types like yourself are going to know exactly what I'm talking about.
Oh, God.
I'm sure Elizabeth, being non-corporeal type, she would feel that too. Shannon, you've got some non-corporeal stuff going on. I'm sure you probably feel times where it's like, is this even really happening? You know, and that's where it stems from, because you're getting a sense that this is sort of a projection. It's a memory of something that happened a long, long time ago in a story that was created so that you could remember it, because even the story is not real. It's just a pattern of energy, because we don't think in vibrations. If I gave you just frequencies of vibrations, how would you be able to discern reality from that? You have to be able to take those vibrations and convert them into some type of story so that it makes sense. That's actually how stereotyping happens. We get very critical of our human brains when we get stereotypical of people. And we say that these people are this way, and that kind of people are that way. But there is actually a function to that. It's just, unfortunately, we do bad things with our minds, and so therefore it becomes hazardous to our social life. But in reality, that stereotyping is about trying to find patterns that we can relate to, which is the same thing. You know what else? We all know stereotyping in a racial sense. We all know that. Oh, we know stereotyping in a cultural sense. We'll say that, you know, all people from the Middle East are bad. You know, there's a big thing in the United States. We feel that way. And of course, it's not true. Nobody could be. Not everybody somewhere could be terribly bad. Bad people everywhere. But we feel that way. That's a stereotype. But it's not wrong, because the same thing that causes us to think that way is the same thing that causes you to see elephants and bunny rabbits in the clouds when you're sitting in the park looking up at the sky on a nice cloud, you know, a nice day with clouds passing by. You'll see faces in the clouds. You'll see animals and shapes and things that look like castles and all sorts of things. And there's no castle up there. There's no rabbit up there. Nobody put the cloud and organized it to make it look like that. Your brain is looking at something that is completely raw data and trying to form something that can be made sense of it. And so it creates the image and say, oh, that looks like a bunny rabbit. So that's what it is. It's It's a stereotype. It's what we do. And our brains do this to make sense of the energy that's around us. This is a vibratory universe. We can't sense it that way because there would be no way of interpreting the information. So what happens is our brains create the story, which is why we relate to stories, which is why archetypes do everything that makes up the phenomenal world. That's why religion is so powerful and why it moves people. The most powerful stories are contained within religion. That's why it makes people do bad things too, because there's too much power there, more than what most people can handle. And you know, it's kind of like giving a child a nuclear weapon. You know, it's not going to end well, but that's exactly what God does. He has a lot of faith in us, more faith in us than we have in Him, I can promise you that.
Yes.
Any other questions, anything else? Nothing that's not clear? You do? Okay. Yeah, sure.
God created man, mm-hmm. He took the man and placed him into the garden.
Yes.
Moved his into the garden. Then he put out man out of the garden and mm-hmm. put him to the east.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Put the flame swords around.
Yes.
Get back. In order for us to go back to where we're supposed to be, we have to go back to the west to get back into our original, that's right, original state. Where we are, where we're supposed to be. The tabernacle in the wilderness,
yeah.
The Holy of Holies, the holy place, mm-hmm. The outer courts, but beyond the outer courts is that wilderness that God set us in, right? In that wilderness is the so-called reality that we see here. That's not real. We got to get back through, and we got to shed off all this stuff that supposedly think we see,
yeah.
And all the emotion and all these things that we are becoming attached to, that
yes.
We think are for real.
Yes.
We have to shed those things off,
yes.
In order to get back to the Holy of Holies. Is this what all this is about? Because you are in my vein, and I'm telling you, I'm so blessed to be here.
I'm blessed to have you.
You just not understand. Because God has been speaking to me from thermodynamics to entropy, and all these different things for 3 years when He removed me out of the church and started saying, let me tell you some things. And everything that you're telling me lines up with the things that He's been telling me. So is that what this is?
You are so on target, you don't even realize
how much.
let me share with something quickly. Let me show you something that's going to really, I think, kind of blow your mind again. We're going to erase this. I think we know what it means at this point. So I want to show you this. This is something that I intended to get to, but we ran out of time.
It's a pretty big subject.
It is. It's really kind of hard. It's hard to cover all this in one lesson.
I mean, this is a lifetime of learning this stuff.
It is. It really is.
That monk and his apprentice is kind of three
measurable eons, yeah. Let's talk about a cosmic vibration. Remember I said everything's vibratory?
Right.
What a cosmic vibration can be defined as is they are the actual atoms that make up the cosmos itself. So we are all existing like microscopic creatures on top of a cosmic vibration, okay? So let me try to put it in perspective for you. You are a human being and you're made up of atoms, right? And you're on top of a planet, right? That's orbiting the sun. And then that sun is orbiting around the center of the galaxy, and that galaxy is moving around in very unusual ways, actually towards a specific point. Everything in the universe, while it's going further apart, is actually all falling in the same direction, though. So that's another story. But something weird's happening at the subatomic, too. And it kind of parallels what's happening at the macrocosmic level. And so imagine, if you will, that the atom, one atom that makes up a molecule, all the molecules in here are billions and billions of atoms, right? Just pick one atom that has an electron circling it, orbiting it in a way, okay? imagine if there was a civilization that lived on that atom. That's kind of us. We are that microscopic to the real macrocosmic universe that's really out there. We're not seeing it because we're too small. So we look out into space and we see this vast expanse and we're like, what is this? But it's, I guarantee you, anything living on top of an electron looking out into the rest of this podium will never be able to discern that it's standing on a podium, that it's living in a podium. They'll never know that all of the things that make up its universe is just a podium. For all we know, we're in the back of a toilet seat somewhere. I mean, it could be that bad. You know, I mean, who knows? We don't know, right? So, in a sense, the every cosmic condition is made up of these same atoms that make up the multiverse, which is, for our purposes, infinite. But it comes out like this when you look at it, and it's really going to blow your mind when you see this. This is going to answer your question that will totally reshape how you're thinking. I should have PowerPointed this. It might have been easier. I'll be a little crude here, but we'll make it work. Remember that mystical point of awakening that we had over here? Remember that? That's right here.
I couldn't see the floor, but look what I just, because you saw what's in
me. There you go. Look at that. That's very, okay. It's getting really interesting now. This is getting really interesting. I love it.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's God's exhale. Okay, here's the Big Bang.
The current Big Bang.
The one that we know about.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for our universe.
Right.
This is heat death. Remember I said that there is the pervading theory right now is that the universe will burn itself out of energy. That's the ultimate demise of entropy. We'll run out of energy and the universe will go cold. But what happens after that? We don't really know. Some people think it just goes indefinitely into nothingness. But metaphysically speaking, we understand it to be the Big Crunch. It actually sort of reconstitutes itself when God puts energy back into it, which we would understand to be at God's inhale. Okay, so this is the Yin principle. This is the Yang, our Yang. Okay, this is entropic universe. Or you could say it's hell. Because nothing lasts forever here. And then this is the ectropic universe. Let's put a U there for universe. And this is heaven. That's the kingdom of heaven that we're all trying to go to. Okay? Remember, mystical point of awakening right here, having to stand between both. And this line represents the evolutionary directive, the hand of God that directs all things. Interesting thing is how time is distorted through this. So think of this as space. Now let's talk about time. We have to think four-dimensionally, and I can't write a fourth-dimensional picture, so we have to kind of symbolically represent it. So here is past, present, and future. Here is future, present, and past. The present is what we know to be reality. The past is what we know to be stored information. The future is what we know to be projections of potentialities. What has been established and is theorized again by a theoretical physicist is that if you encountered a black hole, there is an event horizon around it once you cross the, once something crosses the event horizon, it, there's no escape. You get sucked into the black hole, that's it for you, okay? We, if it was a human being doing it, it would be called spaghettification. You literally get ripped, every atom in your body gets ripped apart. Okay, so it's not a pleasant experience if you could ever get out there. But let's just say for a moment that we decide, you and I, we're tired of sandcastles, we're gonna head out to space now. So we go out into outer space, and we get on a ship. And I tell you, I'm gonna take the shuttlecraft, you command the starship. Okay, so here's our little starship, we'll do like the Starship Enterprise, okay? There we go. And here's our little starship, and I get out in my shuttlecraft, and I start heading towards the black hole. You stay on board the ship, but I go out in the black hole. When I get, as I'm moving towards the event horizon, you and I are gonna be able to have a perfect conversation, no problems. What are you seeing? I'm seeing it's getting close. All right, be careful, Brian. I know you're gonna make it. Yeah. And then I cross the event horizon. When I do that, I get ripped apart into billions, trillions of particles instantaneously. But for you on the ship, it's gonna look like I went in and just stopped for all time. Any ship that passes from now until the end of time is gonna see my little shuttlecraft going towards the event horizon as if it never gets there, frozen in time. I had disintegrated long ago, but because of the distortion of time and space around the black hole, that's how it appears to everything outside of it. When you look up at the stars, nothing's really moving, right? The constellations don't change overnight. It's a slow, almost painfully slow process. That's really what's happening here. It's not that I'm frozen, it's just I'm moving so slow now, from your vantage point, not mine, I'm already gone, but from your vantage point, I'm going so slow, it looks like I'm standing still. When we look out into space, the constellations look fixed. It's because they're moving so slow, we don't see their movements. Why is that? It's because we're actually living within the event horizon of a black hole, a primordial one, though. It's much, something much larger than the ordinary black holes that we see in, or think we see out there in the universe. That's what this is. We live in the entropic universe, the black hole sucking us in slowly towards entropy to the point of heat death. God's in here, right? What is salvation in Jesus Christ? It's a way to come out the other side instead of spaghettification, which is hell. We're already in hell because we're in entropy. Nothing lasts. Nothing's permanent. Nothing's fixed. All change. But real hell, as Jesus tells us, with Gehenna, the trash dump, and the parable of the weeds and the wheat, burn them. Not to punish them, to get rid of them. They're not useful anymore. So it's annihilation. We could call this annihilation. Going into the black hole is annihilation. But what if you could come out the other side? What if there is, and some theoretical physicists really feel, that there is this singularity in the center of a black hole, that if you could, in theory, travel through it, you could come out the other side. Where does it lead? Out of a white hole, in an ectropic universe. In a sense, the salvation of these religions that are teaching eternal life are actually using the faculties of your awareness to influence the non-corporeal movement of the universe, is teaching you, through stories, how to go through a black hole and survive and come out the other side into a reality that will be eternal. That's the new heaven and the new earth. It's an ectropic universe, not an entropic one. That's the reality of religion. That's the actuality of religion. So, when you're talking about black holes, and you're talking about, you know, is this related to what, you know, we've been discussing the whole time, this is essentially what we're trying to achieve to, but it requires a precision. This, what does Jesus say about getting into the kingdom of heaven? That the entrance is so narrow that even a rich man would, you know, a camel would go through the eye of a needle more easily than a rich man going into the kingdom of heaven. Because it's such a narrow path. Actually, the word that was used there was really not camel. The original Greek was actually the word for rope. And it makes more sense that way. Rope going through the eye of a needle instead of camel. But the translators got it wrong. Anyway, it means same meaning. It's a narrow passage.
It's very little.
Very little. And it requires absolute skill. It requires absolute precision. And religion teaches us how to focus our mind to the extent of that skillfulness that will make this journey possible. Which is why when people die and come back and near-death experiences, what's the thing that everyone says they see? A light through a tunnel. You're looking through a black hole, because that's the impression that you get, the last impression you get upon entering the non-corporeal spiritual world, if you want to call it that. It's not really spiritual, it's just non-corporeal. You're not physical anymore, so you're not going to see things as cohesively as you did. That's what the light at the end of the tunnel is. It's the white hole at the end of the black hole. The ancients knew this long before there was theoretical physics, but do you think anyone's talking about it today? Of course not. It's only kept to the mystery schools, unfortunately. I'm probably violating some unwritten law that I shouldn't be sharing this with the public, but I think it's time that we start thinking accurately and stop using religion as a weapon.
That's what the Lord said. He said, I'm about to move the man from one level to another level. And he said, let people know that when it's time to go, don't ask any questions, just move with what he's doing. Just move with what he's doing, he said, because I'm about to move and shift.
Yeah.
This universe. And I'm like, oh my God. You know, I thank God for his time. Yeah, we receive what you have. I bless you. Thank you.
Thank you. That means a lot to me to hear that. Yes. You never know when you go into a group, you never know if people can receive this. Mm-hmm. It's kind of technical. It's a little bit, you know, outside of the path. Well, it's a lot outside the paradigm, right. Most people.
I'm on the edge of my seat. This is so fantastic. Yeah. I felt that we have been in a parallel universe for some time. The universe is exploding. But what you're saying is what I've been feeling. And
yeah.
We're moving to this.
Right. What we're doing, we've been
nirvana.
Even more up to, and that's what you've done. So everybody is here by design.
Seems that way. Everyone seems to be.
And it's just so awesome. You know, I'm glad you've allowed me to come here.
Crazy.
You know, so
not crazy at all.
I know it tells me that. You know, just watch me. You know, and I'm gonna show you everything that he shows me. Everything he tells me. Comes. Every time when I speak it out, because he told me, he said, you've got to tell it. He said, you got to tell it so that the people can catch the spirit. So when he tells me these things, when I'm speaking out, these things are manifesting. So when I'm speaking out these things, because I teach this in my classes, not at the same level that you're teaching me, but my mindset is at that level.
You're intuitive.
And it's harder for me to get it out to teach them because of where their mindset is. And the Lord told me, he said, because until you want to fix an external problem, you're going to have to look on the internal, because we can't fix nothing out there except what's in here. Yeah. We got to fix this in here in order to move it to the next level. So that's what this is all about. This is not nothing that I can touch. This is a totally 100% spirituality of man to move to the level that God, because we are behind. We are in between the yin and yang.
Yeah.
And we trying to get down to the archetype.
Yeah.
He's calling us to get to that archetype because it's like we're behind where we're supposed to be in at. Oh, we've gotten stuck in things from the past and hadn't moved. But he said, guess what? He said, y'all always talk about the man in behind. He said, but the thing is, he said, man can't move until I say it's time for them to move. And he said, now I say it's time for man to move. So
but man still has to be enlightened. But he still has to be enlightened.
Man has to come to agreement.
That's right.
Yeah. With what God is going to do.
And there's too much non-agreement.
Non-agreement.
So there's too much walls they don't want to go over.
It's like you said that. The doorway is so small.
Right.
This is not for everybody. Everybody's not willing to let go of the stuff of this earth that is fleeting away and truly is not even here. Everybody is not willing to accept that the things that you see, you truly don't even see. Everybody's not willing to receive that you're actually living upside down of your own reality. They're not willing to receive that. And when the Holy Spirit told me, he said, it was on my computer 2-3 years back. It was 86 degrees at 9:30 at night in February. And I'm like, no, it's not. It's not that warm this time of year. And the Holy Spirit said, don't believe everything you see and stop receiving everything you hear. And from that right there, that's how come I can dress like this in 104 degree weather, because I'm usually having 3 layers of clothes and I don't get hot and I don't sweat up like other people do with shorts and stuff on. I chose not to believe everything that I see and everything that I believe, because God is teaching me and showing me another way, a better way under him, not under man, and chronology and believing everything that's here. You know, so I thank you.
I thank you. That was one beautiful. Thank you. You know, it's interesting what you said there, you know, because think again, you know, you're looking at the time, how time relates to space. This is space, this is time relating to space. And as you can see, as we move through the black hole, we go from past, present to future, right? Our birth was somewhere in the past. We didn't remember it, but we know from our parents that it happened, right? And then we're living now in the current moment, somewhere on this timeline. And then we know in the future we're going to die. We're going to get there at some point. When Jesus says, the apostles, you know, all these children are coming up to him, and the apostles, you know, are scolding them for bothering him. And Jesus reprimands the apostles back and says, he puts one up on his knee and says, unless you become like these, you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. But when you cross through into the entropic universe, you start at the future point and then you work your way back to the past. You move your way back towards your archetypal child state. And so you return to innocence. You return to the perfection of your youth. You could get forever younger.
Yes.
It's not everything like, you know, what age you're going to be in heaven. It's not like that.
Right.
It's in a state of perpetual improvement instead of a state of perpetual decline. Which we know now. You know, you keep getting older, you keep getting sicker, and eventually, you know, the sickness gets you. You know, it's going to catch up with you.
Because we're going to die.
We're going to
die. Get out of here alive.
Can't get out of here alive. I say that, you know, there's a 100% chance of dying from death. You know, you can't avoid it. And so, in this model, though, if you could enter into the theoretical entropy, and there would have to be, because there's a public condition to everything. That's the one thing that yin and yang teaches us, is that there is no such thing as one condition. There's always a polar condition that supports the previous condition. This universe exists because this one is being created. This universe exists because this one's creating it. And they're both the same.
That's right.
So why? You're like, well, why this life? You live for 8 years, you die. You're feeding energy into this one that doesn't happen in. Because the other, it goes the other way. And there, again, theoretical physics. The physicists have some research that they have come to. I have to remember what article I read it in. But they found that that every universe appears to have the potential of a parallel universe that's just like it. The only difference is, instead of working from past to the future, it works from the future to the past. That's entropic. It's not the same kind of condition. So in here, where you go from a state of perfection into a state of regular decline until death gets you, here you're going from that state of death all the way back into a state of perfection, and that is why Jesus had to die on the cross. What an awful God that puts his son up for torture like that. What kind of God would do that? I hear atheists tell me this all the time. It's like, you know, you're never going to get it, so why should I even try to spend time with him? But this is why he has to die, so that we can live.
Yes.
And the theology has been saying this for 2,000 years, so people don't want to hear it. But it's scientifically valid. If you know how to talk about it, I'm not a scientist, but you know, I did study psychology and anthropology, and I had to take I was pre-med for a while, so I had a little bit of science in my background, not enough to really be a great theoretical physicist, but I do understand these concepts enough that I can say, let's take this and now let's make it make sense what the ancients have been talking about, but they didn't have the science to utilize into this system. That's what esoteric mysticism was. So you guys have given me hope. Maybe I need to publish the book now.
That's what I was going to say. This is the book. I would love
this is
to
the book.
Purchase it. I would love to purchase it.
I will work on getting it done then.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh, yeah. I mean, I'm sorry I missed that first hour, but if you're writing a book about this,
it's going to be online.
Okay.
So
it needs to be done.
Mm-hmm. If you want to pass my cards around, you know, that has the church website on it, and you just go to the YouTube channel.
Okay.
And it will have my previous lecture, which is not quite as interesting as this one. And then it will have the part that you missed.
Great.
Yes, thank you.
Do you have these?
Yes, you can. Pass them out.
Now, the Lord said that we are actually operating that made man was in the beginning God created. And the period of creation is actually, well, a place of creation is actually a place that's untouchable. It's in our mindset. You got to create, think about something before you build it.
Mm-hmm.
So he created man. Then he made man. Two different things. So the Lord is saying that made man is actually operating in the vision that he had. So in the yin and yang, that's where the made, number two, that's where the made man is actually operating, and then in the number one is that at the creation level.
It's just raw potential.
Okay.
It hasn't even reached creation yet.
Okay.
It's
yes.
Before creation even mattered.
Even was.
I mean, but again, remember you're talking timelessness.
Yes.
So to say before creation is kind of paradoxical. It's kind of like saying this. And you're going to really struggle with this one. It's like saying this. How can you reconcile that paradox? But that's exactly what we
I'm just
have
gonna
to
say
do.
Not true. Above is not true. Below is true, but above is not true. So mm-hmm. How do you marry those together?
You can't.
There's no way.
You can't, but this is reality. This is why we struggle. This is
right.
Why there's conservatives and liberals. This is why there's Democrats and Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
This is why there's Christians and Muslims. This is why there's, you know, science and religion. This is why there's love and hate. This is why there's good and evil. Because we live in a reality that cannot separate or reconcile reality. And so what we do is we choose a side and we stick with it. And then we create a paradigm and we do not move outside of it. Too dangerous to do so because you'll lose yourself. You become Christ dying on the cross, and who wants that?
I tell you, because you just.
Oh, you're ready for it.
Bless the Lord. When you told me you're no longer to be called Sister Stewart, you're no longer to be called evangelist, prophetess, minister, you're no longer to be called any of these things. I call you Doretha, and that's your name. That's what I call you. So this is when you talk to me.
Yeah.
So when I talk to other people, I don't call myself minister, sister. My name is Doretha. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me.
I like that.
Because
no,
we have used the titles. Mm-hmm. We use titles to separate us.
Yes.
We use titles to that we are this and we are that and we're not. And we need to eliminate that. I bless the Lord for taking me out of you're supposed to be a Baptist, or you're supposed to be a Pentecostal, or, you know, you see what I'm saying? I am just Dorit, the disciple of the Lord, you know, just me, just him in me, and that's where he's calling for us to be.
What causes aging? What causes us to, our
right.
most primal experience mm-hmm. of entropy is aging, and that is the cells mm-hmm. break, mm-hmm. they create new cells from that, but eventually that process of replication
right.
cannot pass the DNA on in the same in a perfect way forever.
Right.
And eventually the process of cell division becomes distorted, corrupted, and eventually disease and death
right.
occur. That's aging. That's what aging is. If you can reverse that, then you reverse aging.
That's right.
All right. Wholeness would be like the two cells coming back together again
mm-hmm.
and creating a new condition in the reversed way. And so, in a sense, that's exactly what this relationship between yin and yang and the white hole and the black hole, what we're trying to achieve with this understanding of heaven and hell, and it really stems from your original question, like where does hell fit into this? There's really no reason to even talk about it because hell is all we have ever known. We've never known heaven yet. We can just dream about it, theorize about it, think about what it might be like if there was some condition that was that perfect. And for those who have faith, they have faith that that they will somehow achieve to it. And those that don't have just reconciled that this is reality. It's not going to ever get there, so let's deal with what is. It's not a right way or wrong way of dealing with it. It's just the way it is. However, we have to keep in mind that we still are living on the entropic side of things. And here, we know death. On the other side, the ectropic condition, it's just life. You awaken from death forever. And that is what Jesus is trying to say in his theology. That becomes the 2,000-year Christian religion. It's just, he didn't have science back then. If Jesus had come today, he would be teaching something more along these lines than actually teaching, you know, mystical principles. It would just be more of a better semantics. But, you know, even if he did understand these things, he wouldn't be able to share them. Because people wouldn't have gotten it. So he had to talk to people within the context of the people who were his audience, which were Jews. So, of course, it's a carryover of Jewish thinking. So that's why Christianity is sort of the cousin of Judaism, because that was Jesus' audience. If he had gone to the Tibetans, it would have been something that would have related to them, I promise you. You know, but it's just, this is the way it works. You know, there's nothing
wrong. Book of Revelation 22 talks about there's no longer a need for a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. There's
yeah.
only the one tree of life, because that's all.
Here you go. You got it. See? Knowledge of good and evil is duality.
Yes.
Tree of life is wholeness.
It's wholeness.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you, if it's okay, I can hopefully approach you correctly, but just paraphrasing.
Yeah.
You were saying something that we created that fracture in God. And it doesn't mean that God is imperfect, but because he's whole and every just in everything that he does. So that fracture would have been there in the beginning, which is timeless and limitless.
Just the potential. Just the potential for the fracture.
Right.
But it's just like I said, if you can even conceive of existing in a state of the universe is nothing outside yourself. Think you got your body. Anybody watch Star Trek, The Next Generation? Have you seen it? Okay. Do you remember the one where Beverly Crusher is her son is messing with some experiment and people keep disappearing on the ship? And she reaches a point where she's the only one left on the ship. And then she looks outside and sees that it's just like, space is gone, it's just like erased. And so she asks the computer, what's the size of the known universe? And it gives her the dimensions of the ship. And it's because she had been transported to some kind of temporal bubble that was collapsing in on her, and she had left this universe and entered into a pocket of a new universe that was much smaller than the original one she started out in. And in a sense, you could say that there's a lot of that that's happening here with us, because in a sense, this cosmos is collapsing in around us. And what the whole purpose of religion is to teach us, is to teach us how to navigate using the faculties of perception, which are almost exclusively non-corporeal. You said something earlier about you know, we were in a sense a thought, and then we were made. And think about everything that exists. If I want to build a skyscraper, say I'm an architect, you can say God is the great architect. If he wants to build a sky, if I want to build a skyscraper, I'm not just going to say, the skyscraper's there now. I don't have to do anything. Oh, it's, there it is. That's done. I don't go to the skyscraper and say, oh, there's a skyscraper. Now I can make a new one. I have to first think about that skyscraper. I have to design it. I have to put it down on paper and then give it to an engineer to be able to create and build, right? Everything that exists starts out in the non-corporeal. Everything is first completely non-physical, and then it becomes physical over time. And so the cosmos is no different than that. Everything that you see that is of the physical universe started out as a non-corporeal, I don't want to use the word thought, because it really isn't a thought, it's something else that we don't know. God doesn't really have thoughts. We have thoughts. God doesn't need a brain. But whenever, when we can say God's thoughts, because we don't have another word for it, we don't know what those are, but it's like a non-corporeal conceptualization that finds its way into the manifestation through the process of reflection. And so it's kind of like God, you could say, is, if I turned off all the lights in here, and well, I mean, let's actually, you know, put a flashlight on. Could you hit the light for a second? Yeah, I think I can demonstrate this in a way that makes sense. If we look at this, let's say this is the expanse of the void. This is the ether. This is really nothing. It's just the reflective, vibratory surface that's just raw potential. And this is the light of God. Okay, this is God. This is the singularity. As soon as there is the fracture that we talked about, he starts to shine his light. Let there be light, the Bible says. Well, here you go. Let there be light into the void. Okay, so here's the yang, there's the yin, and it starts to form. It becomes an emanation of himself. He creates the means to create a cohesive form. And that's this hand. But we don't experience this hand. We're the shadow. So this, the shadow of my hand on the ether is the human race. God's emanation reflects it. That emanation in Christianity we call the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But in the most ancient of teachings, in Judaism, there was first An Sof, which even transcends the Holy Trinity. That would be the light. And so we're a reflection of a reflection, or you could say, a shadow being cast by the light of God onto an emanation of his very self, which is what it's meant by the scripture. It says we are made in God's image. We're not his essence. We're just an image of what he is. It's just a reflection. And so think of it that way. The light of God, emanation of himself in the form of what, again, in Christianity we call the Holy Trinity, but you know, different religions have different ways of looking at it. And then the human being is the mere shadow. This is the archetypal, my hand is the archetypal reality. The shadow is the story that it creates. And I could build all sorts of stories if I could do shadow puppets. Mm-hmm. I can't. But you know, that's basically a way of demonstrating. You can turn the lights back on. Thanks. People at home didn't see that, but I should have done it over here. But you know, that's basically what it means. So it's just a different way of looking at it. And I think it's a more accurate, a more authentic way of looking at it. And that's what you really want. If you take nothing out of this, at least take the need for authenticity out of it. And how, whatever that means to you, is the direction you need to go. So it might not be Christian religion, that's fine, but you know, find your inner authenticity and then find that mystical point of awakening and then be able to look at both conventional and absolute truth with one eye on each. You ever see the icon of Jesus, the pentacrator? I don't have this icon in my chapel, but I want it. Okay. You ever notice something a little bit unusual about that?
Yeah.
Look at his eyes. They're different.
Different, yep.
Two different eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen this before?
Yes, yes.
Two different eyes. Can you see it? I don't know if they can see it at home, but maybe not. But this, the eye on the left, you're looking at him. His right, your left, is the eye of judgment. And the one that's darker, it looks like it's weeping, is the eye of compassion. It shows Christ's dual nature, his dual role of both being judge and savior. Which is kind of a paradoxical role, isn't it? You know, to be able to judge and yet at the same time to have eternal compassion. And he has to exercise both. He has to reconcile this eternal equation that we are not able to. He can, but we can't. That's the divine benefit. And so in understanding things like the nature of God and Satan, more about integration than it is about contrast or duality or good and evil. We shouldn't shun evil. We should integrate it into its proper place. And the way that that is accomplished is through understanding our responsibility as human beings, which is a great responsibility. So when I get atheists and agnostics saying, you know, why did God let this child, you know, get raped? Why did this, why was this person killed? Why is ISIS beheading people? You know, all these horrible things. And it's like, why are we stopping it?
That's right.
Why is it his responsibility? Right. It's ours. He gave us the power to fix this. We might not have the wisdom or the knowledge that he has, but we have the power to do it. We contain the power of creation. We can have sex and create new life. That's pretty remarkable. I mean, we don't need to ask God, hey, can you give me a child? No, we can just do it. And that's remarkable. He's given us a lot more divine power than we give ourselves credit for. And we don't have the responsibility always to use it. So part of this is also about developing a sense of responsibility and then working towards wholeness in that process. You don't have to be perfect. You don't need to be a genius. You just need to be aware and observe. Don't try not to focus on beliefs, focus on direct observation and your direct experience with God, whatever that means for you, whatever role that story takes in your life. And you will find that the answers come. And this is how we experience God directly, not by proxy, through the scripture, which is wonderful, or church, which is wonderful, or the sacraments, which are wonderful, but the direct experience, once you have that, I can go back. And this is the way that you can do that. Anyone can do it. I have made atheists believers just by utilizing very simple formulas like this. But they have to be serious about putting it into practice. And that's what I teach. I teach archetypal art communication, which gives us the means to communicate with the non-corporeal side of the universe that most of us don't know anything about. It's mysterious and dark. Some people are afraid of it. You know, it has a name. They call it the occult. But it's really, what does the word occult mean? It means secret. It shouldn't be secret. We should be very. We're mostly non-corporeal. I mean, I'm pretty limited. I mean, I'm like 5'11", and I weigh about 200 something pounds, And that's my physical limitations, but inside my mind, I can travel to the most distant universe. There's no limits in here. So my reality is actually far more non-corporeal than corporeal. And yet, because we've been conditioned, that's right. This is the real world, and this is all in your head.
It's
the other way around.
That's right.
You know, you have to get there, and you have to experience it. That's why I said at the beginning of this class, if you can't experience it, you're never going to understand it, because it's not something that you can be taught. It's something you have to be, basically the teaching is, how do you experience it? So I'm hopefully giving you the tools to be able to continue your journey wherever you are at by utilizing what you've learned here today. And with the recording, you can reflect back upon it, because there's probably so much here that is easy to miss.